They call it the Bayou Classic, and for 42 years, it has called New Orleans home. The city that embraces tradition and loves its football invites you inside the Superdome for Southern against Grambling. The Tigers have an 8-game win streak, but a 3-game losing streak against Southern. They've won 3 out of 4 and want nothing more than to hand Grambling its 4th consecutive loss in the Bayou Classic. For over 4 decades, Thanksgiving weekend here inside the Superdome, it's a tradition they call Southern against Grambling for the Bayou Classic. And the Bayou Classic is like so many rivalries over Thanksgiving weekend, so much meeting and tradition. People want to remind you, you can just throw out the records, but we don't want to throw out the records today. We'd like to remind everybody of what a strong game we have here today. Grambling, a perfect 8-0 in the Southwestern Athletic Conference, and Southern, not bad itself, sitting there at 6-2. My partner here this afternoon is Anthony Hare. And Anthony, we just saw that beautiful 8-0 next to Grambling. Why have they not lost yet in conference play?
Well, the main reason we're going to see is the 3rd consecutive year as a starter for Jonathan Williams in the Bayou Classic. He's the greatest multidimensional talent in the Southwestern Athletic Conference, and he's improved every single year as a starter to the point now where he is leading the SWAC in passing yardage and 2nd in the entire country, Paul, in passing touchdowns. So this Southern defense is going to have their hands full.
And where the Grambling offense would like to be explosive, the Southern offense a little bit more efficient.
They show a lot of balance. They do. And the true sophomore quarterback, Austin Howard, he delivers the ball to a number of different weapons on the outside, the most efficient passer in the SWAC this season. And as a true sophomore, he's got a lot of support in the backfield from the leading rusher in the history of the Southern Jaguars, Leonard Tillery, the leading rusher in the SWAC for this season. He's an all-purpose type of back, not only a runner, but a receiver out of the backfield as well.
The Grambling Tigers looking for a 9th conference win this afternoon without a loss before they go on to the conference championship game next weekend in Houston. And the Southern Jaguars want to finish their season in style. The Bayou Classic on the other side of this break. Welcome back to New Orleans, the 42nd Bayou Classic. The Southern Jaguars and the Grambling Tigers at midfield doing the coin flip. A little reminder of how much history and tradition we have here inside the Superdome. They did it for the first time here in New Orleans back in 1974. Played that one in Tulane Stadium. They needed a bigger facility, so they brought it here inside the Superdome. It's been here every year since. Moments ago, our Lewis Johnson on the sideline with the Grambling head coach, Broderick Fobbs.
Well, Coach, last year when both teams took the field, a trip to the SWAC championship was on the line. This year, you know you're there. What have you said to your team about not looking past this moment, this game today?
Well, it's impossible to look past this particular game. If you look at the atmosphere, there's no way you can look past it. This is a game that all these kids have dreamed about playing in. They know each other. It's a sibling rivalry. So we just look forward to the contest today.
And we do, too. Good luck today. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Broderick Fobbs on one sideline, on the other sideline for the 4th year as the head coach, Dawson Odoms. And Anthony Heron, it was his team the last 2 years that went on from this game, the Bayou Classic, to play in the conference title game. It's not going to be the Jaguars this year, but they've won 3 of the last 4 games, and I think safe to say peaking at the right time.
Each of these head coaches have had a bit of a reclamation sort of project that they had to make with these institutions, and it's great to see that now for 2 consecutive years, each team playing at a very high level. And Dawson Odoms, he was more of a disciplinarian, came in and established that. Roger Fobbs, the coach who came in with detail and made sure he quickly turned around this Grambling Tigers football team.
Starting quarterback there for Southern, Austin Howard, started this game a year ago. He comes in with a perfect 1-0 record in the Bayou Classic. And getting it back to Broderick Fobbs, Anthony, it is amazing. It was only 2 years ago. The program was in disastrous shape, only 1 win in that season, 1-11. Since then, he took over a couple weeks after the Bayou Classic. His Tigers are 15-2 in conference play. It's truly amazing.
They were 1 win away. It was this game last season, as we heard Lewis Johnson talking about, that was determining who would represent the Western Division in the SWAC championship game. To do that in his first year, it just speaks volumes for not only his love of this program as an alum, but his abilities as a head coach. I believe we're looking at 2 of the top 3 head coaches in the SWAC Conference.
You mentioned he's an alum, played running back under the legendary, the late, great Eddie Robinson from 92 until 95. And I know you like defense, Anthony, former Big Ten defensive lineman and also in the National Football League, but I'm kind of hoping for what we had last year when it was 52-45 when offense took over.
I don't know if that's possible. Could we possibly get 97 points on the board again this season? It was a Bayou Classic record we had, came down to the very final play of the game. So much drama.
We just saw number 25, Willie Quinn, the receiver slash returner for the Southern Jaguars. Might be a good idea, Anthony, to keep it away from him. He has 5 total return touchdowns this season, and keep it away from him is what they do, but still Southern with a nice return out past the 35-yard line, a return of 21 yards for the wide receiver Mike Jones, who had 130 receiving yards in the Bayou Classic last year. So you saw Austin Howard moments ago, number 7, sitting on the bench. I mentioned he's 1-0 in the Bayou Classic. He also comes in extremely hot. The last 2 games, 36 out of 48. That's 75%, 6 touchdowns, and no interceptions. And as Anthony talked about in the open, not a bad idea to turn and hand it off to number 21, Leonard Tillery, now over 3,000 career yards, the career rushing leader for the Southern Jaguars. And right to the air, fires it incomplete, looking for Willie Quinn to bring up 2nd down and 10.
There's some impact players on the football field for each of these teams. For Southern offensively, fast Willie Quinn. We just talked about his dynamic abilities as a kick return man. Randall Menard, who didn't play last season but is now in the lineup again, he's a big play threat for them on the outside as a wide receiver.
Menard and Quinn, quite a 1-2 combination of wide receiver, but this is an offense, the Southern offense, that really likes to run more than it passes. And why not with the Southwestern Athletic Conference number 1 rusher in Tillery? 2nd consecutive time to the air. 1st down, Jaguars inside Grambling territory. That is a gain of 18 for Mike Jones.
Seeing more depth early in the game here, just a few snaps in from the secondary of Grambling than what we see overall. They were a team, especially last season, a lot of AMC, always man coverage, safeties very tight to the line of scrimmage. Seeing a little more depth in the secondary this year.
Mike Jones, 3 catches for 130 yards and 2 touchdowns in last year's Bayou Classic. 3rd consecutive time to the air, and Jones was thinking about running that one before he hauled it in. And that'll bring up 2nd down and 10.
It's a Grambling defense that uses a lot of different looks up front. Guy Stallworth, one of the best cover corners on the outside. Arquez Cooper leads them in tackles. Troy Roach, a guy who can play at the 2nd and 3rd level. But Jamison Goins may be the best pass rusher they have in the defensive front. We'll see a lot of movement from the linebackers. They call it prowling when they're stemming around at the 2nd level.
Number 54, Anthony Arquez Cooper, also number 2 in the conference in tackles for loss. And there's Jones coming up with it. They come right back to him after he dropped it. And that's Howard to Jones for a gain of 7, and that will bring up 3rd down and 3.
It'll be a big onus on the outside for these corners to come up and make tackles in space, because Southern looks for opportunities to throw the ball deep, especially off the play action, but a lot of the completions will be short with run after catch opportunities.
See how well this afternoon Grambling can get after Howard, who has been excellent at avoiding pressure, the least sacked quarterback in the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Plenty of time, another 1st down. Willie Quinn inside the 30 and down to the 27-yard line. That's a gain of 13 and a Jaguar 1st down.
Willie Quinn, season after season, plays in this Bayou Classic. People look at him, he's only 5'5", but he's earned the respect not only of his teammates, but of opponents around the Southwestern Athletic Conference because of his playmaking ability.
Well, the Jaguars, after I've said they like to run it more than they pass, Anthony, have thrown it every single time in the last 4 games. A stretch they won 3 of those 4 games, had run it over 70% of the time. So changing it up here, and Howard looking deep to a wide open Willie Quinn. Touchdown, Southern.
Set that one up off the double move. Saw the ball handling in the backfield from Austin Howard here. Pump fake to the outside. Jatiri Pouncey bites up. And then the safety from a spacing standpoint just can't quite get over in time. to be in position to make the play on Fast Willie Quinn.
Willie Quinn last year in the 52-45 Southern win, as that one did not sneak inside the uprights. Missed extra point at 6-0. Willie Quinn touchdown in last year's Bayou Classic. It has the first score of the game. Six plays, 63 yards, and Southern has an early lead. The Bayou Classic on NBCSN is brought to you by Coors Light, official sponsor of HBCU Classics for over 25 years. And by McDonald's. Also by Allstate, proud sponsor of the Bayou Classic. Are you in good hands? Southern quarterback Austin Howard had the good hands of Willie Quinn to end that drive. Touchdown catch last year in this game. Touchdown catch to end the first drive here, less than 2 minutes into it. After a mixed extra point, the Jaguars on top 6-0. Paul Burmeister and Anthony Heron in the booth. Lewis Johnson on the sideline for the 42nd annual Bayou Classic. The Jaguars special teams in a rough stretch here, missing the extra point. And then kicking that one out of bounds.
They've struggled quite a bit this season in special teams.
Kick out of bounds, the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down, Grambling.
It's one of the things that Dawson Odoms is credited to, some of the struggles, some of the inconsistencies they've had, and not quite getting the win and loss record they had last year.
Number 17 is Jonathan Williams, the senior out of Tampa, Florida, starting his third Bayou Classic, but looking for his first Bayou win. Had a lot of success in the air last year, threw for 450 yards and four touchdowns. His team came up a touchdown short. Flushed out of the pocket, keeps it himself, and that'll be a Grambling first down inside of Southern territory. The Tigers' leading rusher a year ago, showing off that skill right now with a pickup of 23.
I believe this will have to be a big part of the game plan for Grambling today, because this Southern defensive front can pressure the quarterback without additional rushers. We'll see situational blitzing from the Jaguars, but Jonathan Williams using his legs will be key.
There's the inside give. And that's a pickup of three.
Some of the impact players on the offensive side. Martez Carter is a player who's not going to start the game, but when he comes in, very explosive. Chad Williams, the leading receiver in the Southwestern Athletic Conference, and Chester Rogers, a great 1-2 combination. Justin Miller, the best pass protector they have up front.
That 1-2 combination good for over 3,700 career receiving yards. And that's Williams catching it the second time, getting up just across that or right at the 35-yard line. Pick up a four.
I've referenced up front how Southern can get after the quarterback without blitzers. That's because Danny Johnson can lock it down on the outside at corner. Kentavious Preston may be the biggest hitter in the SWAC this season. Gabe Eccles is a nose, and I love the way he plays up front. Daniel Brown is Mr. Intensity. When you see him make a play, better watch out for a show.
Third down and three, Justin Kelly, the tailback to the right of Williams. To the air, stand and fire, and that one knocked down. Southern defense there to make the play. That's Martin Henry to knock it down.
There's a level of comfort. We see the mechanics season by season continuing to improve for Jonathan Williams. He looked very comfortable in the pocket there as a passer. Chris Brazil not able to evade the defender there and kind of get some separation there for Jonathan Williams to deliver the football.
Tigers showing they're going to go for it here on fourth down. 6 out of 11 so far this season converting in fourth down situations. It's been a potent offense, averaging 44 points per game. This is their first drive, fourth and three. Pitch, catch, first down, Grambling. Eight yards to Verlin Hunter.
A good response so far from the Tigers, using the tempo. Now both teams go no huddle, but Grambling was 10th in the SWAC throughout the season in time of possession, but they could care less. They don't need to possess the football. They just put points on the board.
Quick pitch to Kelly, cuts it up. Nice job of staying on his feet, almost to the 20-yard line, picks up six, and that'll bring up second down four.
ball through the bulk of the season. This offense turned Jonathan Williams into a volume passer. What we've seen in recent weeks, roughly over the past month, is them using the run game with Martez Carter, with Justin Kelly, just to add a little bit more balance than what we saw earlier in the season.
Quickly out to the left, and that's Hunter once again. That's another Tiger first down. Pick up a 9 yards. Tackle made by Javon Allen.
Little tunnel screen, and Trent Scott, the left tackle, out in space, blocking downfield. This is what they do. They put people on the run, bodies moving the opposing bodies.
Grambling scored touchdowns 35 out of 41 times in the red zone this season. No surprise for a team that's hit over 40 points the last three games. Over 40 points five times this year. They hit 50 once, and they also went over 70. To the ground, out to the 11-yard line. That is a gain of 1 yard. Justin Kelly, the carrier. And really, Anthony, it's the ground game that's been a surprise this year, a pleasant surprise for Grambling. They knew they were going to be strong in the passing game with Williams and Chad Williams and Chester Rogers back, but the emergence of Carter and Kelly, not only a surprise for this team, but really the entire conference.
It has been, and it's what puts additional pressure on the defense, because you can't just fly into the backfield as you did throughout the season last year.
Williams with the catch and leaving it a little behind. And you can say Chad Williams saying, put that one out in front of me just a little. A little underthrown to make it incomplete.
We'll see the number 10s match up quite a bit throughout the game. Danny Johnson, 3 interceptions on this season. Second consecutive year he's led Southern in interceptions. He'll be matched up man-to-man on the outside. Quite often it'll be Chad Williams when they have him outside at that X receiver position.
10th play of this drive, 3rd down and 9 for Grambling. Williams flushed out to his right, in trouble. Buys a little extra time and fires it out of the back of the end zone.
That's a bit dangerous from a decision-making standpoint, but we've seen Jonathan Williams and these receivers for Grambling get away with it at different points throughout the season. Threw the ball into traffic after, you know, extending the play, evading the rush. But luckily for Grambling, not intercepted, threw it out the back of the end zone.
So Mark Orozco on to attempt a field goal from 28 yards out. It would cut the Southern lead in half. And that's exactly what he does. So the Tigers convert a key 4th down. Get close to a touchdown, but settle for a field goal. The 42nd Bayou Classic has 9:54 left in the first, and Southern has a 3-point lead. The Jaguars and the Tigers have both had one possession here in the 42nd Bayou Classic. Southern scored a touchdown, but missed the extra point. Grambling just kicked a 29-yard field goal, and there we are, 6-3, about halfway through the first quarter. And there's Willie Quinn, 5 return touchdowns already this season, Anthony. As dangerous a return man as you'll see, FCS or in the FBS.
That's why we continue to see these pooch kicks from Grambling, doing everything they can to keep the ball away from fast Willie Quinn.
Mike Jones with his second time he's had his hands on a kickoff. He also has 2 receptions already this afternoon. Had 3 for 130 in the game last year. 2 of those went for scores.
He's one who really got them on the board early in the season. And Dawson Odoms, a little bit more of a defensive mentality he has as a head coach, and he instilled that same type of mentality coming in, taking the program over. He had the interim tag on him when he took over for Stump Mitchell back in 2012, and then immediately was able to turn the program around. Went to back-to-back Southwestern Athletic Conference championship games for 2013 and 2014. This season, not that level of success on the field, the wins and losses. We already know that Grambling will represent the Western Division in the SWAC championship game next week.
And once again, Austin Howard coming out firing. That's Willie Quinn. Nice diving catch for 9 yards. So Howard has the top rusher in the Southwestern Athletic Conference, number 21, Lennard Tillery, yet to touch the ball. It's been nothing but pass for Southern. That first drive ended with a touchdown toss to Quinn. And the first one starts with a connection there. And Austin Howard is on fire. Now inside of Grambling territory, that is a gain of 20.
And now we do see some tempo coming here from Southern. They're a team who normally goes no huddle. We watch the mechanics in the pocket there operating around the rush from Austin Howard. But now they do appear to be displaying more tempo with their no huddle.
Nico Talbert with that catch. Howard keeps it himself, and that's going to be an easy first down. And he slides just before he got to the 20-yard line. Howard's been hot passing it, but that time keeps it himself for 21.
What I believe we're seeing schematically here, Paul, is this was a situation where Grambling did go man coverage this time. Defensive backs were turned to Austin Howard. He took advantage of it with the huge running lane.
There's a reason why he's at least sack quarterback in the SWAC. Late flag, we had some movement just before the snap.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And Paul, the top-ranked rush defense in the SWAC does belong to Grambling State. Its lowest-ranked pass defense belongs to the Tigers as well. And so schematically early in the game, the offensive coordinator for Southern, Chad Germany, he does like to script the initial 12 to 15 plays of the game. So obviously they have come in with an idea to throw the football early, see if they can loosen up that secondary, and then get Lennard Tillery involved as we move forward.
Yeah, the Grambling defense last in passing defense, however, number two in sacks in the conference, and also number one in takeaways with 29. Howard to Tillery, first time he's touched the ball, bursts across the 20-yard line and picks up seven.
There's a bit of a gopher broke sort of scheme to the way that Grambling operates defensively. They love to prowl around. They use a lot of stem from the linebackers, normally bringing at least five rushers. A lot of the times they're blitzing the A-gap, using a run blitz sort of look to it. So that really adds to the way they can try to stop the opposing run game, but it does put additional pressure on the secondary.
Good decision from Howard to dump it off Tillery. Manageable second down here now, second down and seven from the 18-yard line. And there's Tillery out to the 15, picks up three.
Part of the numbers for Grambling's defense are a bit skewed, just to be fair along there, because there's been some games where they've been out to big leads and teams have had to throw the football, airing it out to try to get back in the game. So this is an improved defense over how they operated last year. I do believe that, you know, defensively they don't put the defense in as many binds, especially the secondary, as what they did last season. Guys are tackling much better.
Jaguars 39 out of 46. They've scored that many times inside the red zone this year. Howard keeps it alive, now keeps it himself. And that's going to be awfully close to a first down. He picks up five. And it looks like it's just enough for a Southern first. It's the second time on this drive. Howard wanted to throw, but kept it himself. The first time he went for 21. That time on third and four, he gets five. So now it's first down and goal, Southern.
Howard still in the game at quarterback. This is an area of the field where Southern brings in Deontay Shorts, the backup quarterback, who's more of a running threat situation.
Grambling brings four. Again, Howard with time. And gets to the 7-yard line. Had a couple of initial looks, and he picks up two. Nice job by that Grambling secondary, because even though he had time, Anthony, he had nowhere to go with it.
That pass rush finally starting to get home a bit more. And so Austin Howard having to use his legs to evade rushers, try to hurt the defense there. Artes Cooper doing a nice job working his way back downhill. That's what you have to do when you're rushing the edge and the offensive tackle opens up and that quarterback takes off. You got to get back downhill.
No surprise to see 54 Cooper in the backfield. 12 and a half tackles for loss this year. That's second best in the SWAC. The give to Tillery, leaps his way across the 5-yard line. He was down before the ball came out. Pardon me, that is Malcolm Crockett carrying the ball for Tillery.
Malcolm Crockett, a Pitt transfer, able to leap over one of the defenders and then getting caught in midair. Took a big hit there. Did everything he could trying to hold on to the football.
He's been active the last three games, double-digit carries in each of those three games. First three-game stretch, he's done that all season.
Guy Stallworth, who came up with the big hit.
Third down and goal now, Tillery back in. And back to the air goes Howard.
And Randall Menard had an excellent chance to catch that one, but Dwight Amphy got the hands in late.
This is what Southern was missing last season with Randall Menard out of the lineup. They didn't really have a guy they felt comfortable throwing the fade routes to when they got down in the red zone, but Menard at 6'3" and very long arms, an angular sort of target on the outside, but well executed in the secondary from Dwight Amphy.
Let them play down there in the end zone, Anthony. Good amount of contact.
I don't mind that one bit. I'm biased. You know, like you said it, I'm a defensive guy. There's some hand fighting and jostling going on.
Fourth and goal. Back to the same play. And that time, Anthony is called. Looked a lot like the play before, but this time the flag came out.
The difference on this snap, from the way I saw it, initially, Randall Menard is the one who initiates the contact, and so you understand that. But then the hold that came from Amphy at the end, once Menard tried to work his way and disengage, there was a tug at the jersey.
Pass interference. Number 3 on the defense. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line.
Menard comes off the line of scrimmage. He's working away. Amphy gets his hands into him, starts tugging at the jersey. That's where you get into some trouble as a corner.
But Broderick Fobbs was looking for the flag to get picked up. He thought it wasn't catchable. Referees disagree. The penalty stands, and it's first down and goal. So as Anthony pointed out, Grambling came into this one with the number one rushing defense in the conference. So Southern's play calling has reflected that. Two drives in, 10 passes, and only 5 runs. Malcolm Crockett, the tailback. Howard keeps it himself, fights his way down to the 2-yard line. Grambling defense there to keep him from going any further. And that's Derwin Butler with the tackle.
One of the things that tends to happen in Southern's run game is they do a lot of pulls and traps, especially from the guard position. And even their center, Terrell Lee, is very athletic. So after the snap, Terrell Lee snaps the ball, pulls out. So it behooves the defenders to work from the backside. Whenever you see that puller, especially here inside the 5-yard line, get into penetration mode. Work your way into the backfield. Chase the football down from behind.
12th play of this drive coming up. Tillery back into tailback. The first drive ended for Southern with a touchdown toss from Howard to Willie Quinn. Tillery around the left side. Touchdown, Jaguars.
The former walk-on, Lenard Tillery, from this pistol set. The Southern prefers to run the football, allows Tillery to get more downhill. And this wasn't an easy touchdown. There's a lot of great jerseys there trying to keep them out. They would just reach the football over the goal line.
Lenard Tillery has scored a touchdown now in all but one game this year. He's taken a backseat to the passing game so far through two drives. The Jaguars have taken a 9-point lead.
The previous play is under review.
We'll take a look and see if Lenard was actually, or if he did make it into the end zone.
And as he was reaching the football out, there's a body, there's a number of bodies, but one of his teammates, as Tillery reaches the ball out there, it's actually Jamal Bolden. The knee ends up knocking the ball out late, so they're going to review this, and this is unique to the Bayou Classic here, where it's a nationally televised game. The SWAC has the opportunity to review these plays, and so for a couple of years now, they've been taking advantage of it. So it's just like any standard major college football game where each play will be able to be reviewed throughout the game. I think, if from what I've seen so far, that my belief is that this call should stand. It looks like before he lost the football, it had already crossed the plane at the goal line.
It looked to be pretty clearly in. That knee that knocked the ball out was about half a yard into the end zone. Difficult to tell from that angle.
And referencing knees there, Paul, even if there were a chance that Lenard Tillery's knee was maybe down before he's reaching the football in, I don't see any indisputable evidence that would really show where his knee was if it wasn't actually down before he crossed the goal line. I think at least this call should stand, if not be confirmed.
And clearly the ball was across the goal line. Difficult to tell exactly where his knee was with all that traffic. But you mentioned indisputable when you can't quite tell. The one thing you can see is the ball across the stripe.
A couple of reviews in last year's game. Of course, the one that ended the contest when Grambling had the football trying to drive down to tie it in the highest scoring game in Bayou Classic history. That's a contest they've been reliving over and over again since last season where Grambling had a shot.
After review, the ruling on the field stands as called. Touchdown.
So there is the official touchdown for Leonard Tillery, the all-time leading rusher for the Southern Jaguars, and that's two drives and two touchdowns for Southern so far today. Broderick Fobbs, his team hasn't lost yet in conference play, but his team has yet to stop the Southern offense today. That time, they make the extra point. So the Jaguars now have one passing touchdown, one rushing touchdown, and a 10-point lead. Wednesday night is rivalry night here on NBCSN. This time it'll be a battle of New York as the Rangers take on the Islanders at their new home. Coverage begins 7 o'clock Eastern. The NHL is on NBCSN. And the Bayou Classic for the 42nd year is here in New Orleans for the 41st time inside the Superdome. Offense is clicking here today. Three possessions, two for Southern. One for Grambling. Each has ended in a score for the Jaguars. They scored a couple of touchdowns. And the Grambling offense, after cashing in with a field goal after its first drive, will begin its second on the 26-yard line. Southern on top of Grambling by 10. Right to action. That's his Grambling's first play of the second drive. No gain. Christian Allen there for the tackle for Southern. Ball carry number 4, Martez Carter, averaging an amazing 8.6 yards per attempt this season. Not just on a few carries. He's got 837 yards.
One of the leading rushers in the SWAC, really explosive with the ball in his hands, and it shows. It's part of why Southern's been pooch kicking as well, because he's on that kick return team.
Williams off his back foot just fires that one away. Southern defense, no surprise, Anthony, to see them getting to a quarterback. They have the number 1 and number 2 sack specialists in the conference. Aaron Tiller wears number 94, and Daniel Brown is number 98.
They can bring it off the edge, Paul. They don't need additional rushers to get home on the quarterback. They got Gabe Eccles in the middle to help stop the run. You mentioned Tiller and Brown coming off the edge. They play with energy.
Third down and 10. They're kind of down. Williams flushed once again outside the pocket, and that's the second play in a row. He just had to get rid of it.
They ended up adding Kentavious Preston to the rush for Mike Linebacker. Wasn't an opening day starter, but just plays with such ferocity. He's able to go sideline to sideline. He chases people down. Very athletic. You see him there just come flying into the picture, getting the big hit on Williams.
Couple of small wins for that Jaguar defense early, holding Grambling to only a field goal when they were on the move in that first drive, and now forcing a 3-and-out. Willie Quinn not going to get his hands on that one either. When we come back, we'll see if the Southern Jaguar offense can stay hot. They score touchdowns to finish each of their first two breaks, first two drives, and then lead by 10.
The party, the purpose, the performances. Get
back in New Orleans. Southern up 13-3 over Grambling, and the Grambling defense getting an earful a few moments ago. They're frustrated with their linebackers. One of the coaches saying that, look, Southern's not doing anything we haven't seen before, but we are a step slow. And what's so interesting about that is that usually early in a game like this, where there's so much emotion and passion, the coaches are saying, settle down and get your emotions in check. But I've heard them saying the exact opposite, turn the emotion up, because they need more of it, but get up to speed. That's the Grambling defense. That's what they've got to do right now to try and get back in this game.
Lewis, thank you very much. Anthony, go ahead.
and Lewis was referencing there, the sort of sibling rivalry. It's what Robert Fobbs uses to describe the relationships between these two teams. Their special teams coach, Terrence Graves, very similar in that way as well. But Everett Todd, the defensive coordinator, a guy who's had, you know, relationships at both schools as well.
Austin Howard now awfully effective. He moves to 8 out of 12 for 105 yards here. Still in the first quarter, he is also the leading rusher for Southern with 28 yards. So Lou was talking about the Grambling defense and the message the coach has given them. They need to get the quarterback for Southern, Austin Howard, under control. That time the ground game picks up 6. Brought down by Troy Roach. That's Malcolm Crockett picking up a Jaguar first down.
He's got a very downhill running style to him, is Malcolm Crockett. Bigger than Lennard Tillery. Outweighs him by in the range of 15 to 20 pounds. Puts a different type of pressure on the defense when he's carrying the football.
You mentioned Tillery, former walk-on. As recently as 2012, Anthony, he spent his Saturdays waiting tables, keeping an eye on the game when he could. Now third year as a starter, over 3,000 yards, and already the Jaguar career-leading rusher. And that's a quick pitch and catch to quick Willie Quinn. Second play in a row. The Jaguars pick up a first down. That's a gain of 12.
This is part of what's made Austin Howard the most efficient passer in the SWAC, because of the fact that he's got weapons like Willie Quinn. He can deliver the football too short. Quinn can still make plays after the catch, moving the chains.
Southern getting used to having its drives end up inside of Grambling territory. Third consecutive drive they've been there. The first two ended in touchdowns.
That's why it's so important for the defensive backs to be able to come up and tackle, not miss him when he plays one-on-one in space.
There it is again. There's Quinn, this time to the left side. And brought down by the top tackler here for the Tigers. That's Guy Stallworth, keeping it to a gain of 4.
You see all these gray jerseys rallying to the football, trying to shut down any cutback lane that Willie Quinn may have. That's going to be extremely important for people like Quinn and Tillery, who are so dangerous when they're in space.
Willie Quinn took the entire Bayou Classic last year to have 5 catches and a touchdown. Has 5 receptions and 1 touchdown already as we approach the 1-minute mark of the first quarter.
You see the prowling from the linebacker position.
Howard keeps it himself. This will be another Southern first down. If he could have kept his feet, would have been more. But that's the Southern leading rusher today. He picks up 8.
Turf Monster ended up getting him at the end.
Lives inside every stadium.
Nice ball handling in the backfield, in the cutback lane from Howard. He's not the athlete that Deontay Shorts is when they bring the backup quarterback into the game, but Howard is most certainly dangerous enough with his legs.
Brings up first down and 10 now from the 34-yard line. 20 seconds and counting remaining in the first quarter. Southern winning 3 of its last 4 games here, ending the Bayou Classic, where Grambling is on an 8-game winning streak. Tillery out of the backfield. Spin move going nowhere. Brought down by Jatarius Bouncy. Loss of 5.
That's a good tackle. They're one-on-one in the open field.
Hey, Anthony, we promised offense here in the 42nd Bayou Classic, and that's exactly what we have, combined with just enough defense so far. One quarter in the books, and the Jaguars on top of Grambling.
Second quarter of the Bayou Classic about to get underway. You'll notice on some of the players' helmets and on the field, the number 33, that is for Devon Gales, a Southern wide receiver who suffered a severe spinal injury back on September 26th during a loss at Georgia. Now, he underwent surgery the next day in Athens to stabilize that spine, and I spoke with his mother, Tanisha Gales, yesterday from the Shepherd Center in Atlanta that specializes in spinal cord and brain injuries. And the first thing she told me is that Devon is doing great. He's working hard in the gym from 9 to 4, takes a lunch break, and then he's right back at it. He's undergoing 4 types of therapy right now. And just as he did in football, she said Devon is giving it his all. And, you know, they tell him in the gym, we want you to lift 5 pounds. And he says, no, I can lift 10. So for his mom, that's really the best thing to see, is that he has such a great spirit and attitude, which helps her. Now, guys, before I throw it back to you, she did mention a couple of times Mr. James Shepard, who actually founded the center. He apparently was watching the game back on September 26th. He saw the injury, and he called somebody at the University of Georgia, and he says, I'm going to hold the bed for Devon, so when he's ready, we want to have him transported to our facility so we can take care of him. So that's where Devon is right now, watching this game with his mom, and she couldn't be more thankful for the care he's getting. And so, Devon, we wish you the best as he continues to recover from a pretty tough injury. Great spirit from her and her son.
Lewis, thank you there on third down and 15. Great strike from Howard to Willie Quinn. Picks up 14 to bring up fourth down and short.
It's one of those really scary moments that tend to occur on a football field at all levels when you're talking about Devon Gales. And one of the things that a lot of people, Coach Dawson Odoms and folks all around the Baton Rouge community have made note of, is the fact that folks in the Georgia program have really wrapped their arms around Devon Gales throughout the season.
Fourth down and one, Southern going for it, giving it to the top rusher in the conference. Picking up two is Lennard Tillery, and that's first down Southern.
Whenever we see Southern get into this pistol backfield set right now, Tillery's offset. But whenever he goes into the home position, neutral, behind the shotgun quarterback in a pistol set, it's got to be a run key for Grambling.
There he is, out of that set, spinning his way inside the 15, fumbles the ball. And Southern believes they had bounced on it, and they do.
Gotta love the hustle.
It's Anthony Mosley, big number 75. Great save there for the Jaguars.
One of the team leaders up front is Jaguars offense. Mosley at about 280 pounds, hustling downfield. On the zone blocking scheme, all the big bodies moving in the same direction. Mosley hustling out of the stack. Could have been a big turn of events there for the Grambling defense. The hustling offensive lineman making the play.
Nice play by Guy Stallworth, the safety. Seen him all over the field already, knocking the ball loose. Grambling coming on the blitz. Howard stands in and fires low to Mike Jones to bring up third down and two.
As we've seen, Dwight Amphy not really concerned with getting handsy in coverage. It's one of the things that I did feel like the secondary for Grambling maybe lacked a bit last year, especially once they got closer and closer to the red zone, the ability to impede the progress of wide receivers from the opposing teams running their routes.
Third string tailback for Southern in right now, that's John West. The Jaguars decide to keep it on the ground, and they do. West going to be a yard short after he picks up two. Tackle made by Troy Roach.
That's a bit of a tendency breaker there. I really anticipated with West being in the game, the biggest back that they have for Southern, he might have been in for pass protection purposes.
So just moments ago, Dawson Odoms chose to go for it just like this on fourth down and one. And they gave it to Tillery, the tailback. If they go with the tailback again, this time it's number three, Malcolm Crockett. 13th play of the drive, fourth down and one. Crockett putting his head down, and he is right at the first down mark. Excellent job by the Grambling defense. Derwin Butler there to lead the charge.
Number 36 from Grambling must lead the game for one.
Southern believes they picked up that first down. Grambling not so sure.
Was it spotted with the left foot or the right foot?
First down.
All right. As you referenced, Paul, met in the hole by Butler. Crockett continuing to drive the legs. They gave him
Grambling
forward progress.
Their first charge timeout will be a 30-second timeout in Lynn.
Broderick Fobb's going to meet with his defense here. Dawson Odoms going to talk it over with the offense. Another great drive by the Southern offense. First two ended in a touchdown, and now they're moving further and further. That's two times inside of Grambling territory on this drive alone. They've converted on fourth down in a yard with the ground game.
And Grambling just hasn't had the ability to pressure the quarterback without the additional rushers. Comparing this game with last season's Bayou Classic, we have seen more penetration into the backfield from not only the defensive front, but also from the linebacker position from Grambling State. they're lacking a bit, I think, just in the playmaking ability of the people with their hands in the dirt.
Hey, Anthony, we talked about the Southern offense right when we came on the air, top of the broadcast, and I called Jaguar offense efficient, and you used the word balance, and we're seeing that on this drive. 13 plays so far, 7 of them passing, and 6 times they've kept it on the ground. See where they go here on first down and 10. And that was interesting, non-traditional, little collision between Tillery and Howard. No gain. We'll see what they can come up with on second down 10.
Broken play in the backfield. Tillery confused with the direction of the play call itself. The last season, I would have just assumed that that was on Austin Howard since he was a true freshman last year. Now he's a true sophomore. He's played a lot of games. Who knows? Either one of them could have messed up.
Either way, second down 10. Howard taking his time at the line of scrimmage. His tailback is the school's all-time leading rusher. Number 21, Leonard Tillery fakes the pitch. That was a good idea. Keeps it himself and fights his way to the end zone. Austin Howard, 13-yard touchdown, and look at that. The Jaguars up 19-3.
This is a fake worthy of an and-one mixtape. A little Magic Johnson action there. Fakes it to Tillery on the outside. The defense bites, gives him just enough of a crease for Austin Howard to put his head down and barrel in the end zone.
Austin Howard, excellent passing numbers coming into this game. Completing over 75% the last couple of games. With an excellent mix today of the run and the pass. 7 carries for 49 yards and a touchdown. The Jaguars have 3 wins in a row over Grambling. And right now they have a 17-point lead. The Bayou Classic on NBCSN is brought to you by Coors Light, official sponsor of HBCU Classics for over 25 years. And by Allstate, proud sponsor of the Bayou Classic. Are you in good hands? Southern Jaguars off to a great start here. The 42nd Bayou Classic. Austin Howard using his arms, using his legs. And the Jaguars on top 20-3. Last drive, 15 plays, 69 yards. And 2 times they converted 4th down and 1. 3 drives, 3 touchdowns for Southern. The high-scoring offense, the Grambling, certainly has its work cut out for right now. I mentioned that Dawson Odoms and his Jaguars have won 3 consecutive times here in the Bayou Classic. It's been pretty streaky since 2002. No real long streaks, but one team will get on a roll, the other one jumps in. And Southern has not lost to Grambling since 2011.
Dawson Odoms 3-0 in his time as a head coach in the Bayou Classic. It's impressive.
Tigers right to the ground. Justin Kelly, the tailback, for 3. A little more perspective on how much Southern's offense is controlling this game. That drive that ended with a touchdown was 15 plays. Grambling had only 13 plays in the entire first quarter.
I haven't been nearly as surprised by Southern's offensive production as I have by the lack of productivity from Grambling's offense.
An offense that's gone over 40 points the last 3 games. Still plenty of time. Pick up 3 right there, but so far the Southern Jaguars offense and defense getting it done. That's Kentavious Preston with a tackle there.
There's a lot of similarities to the way that Grambling operates under Broderick Fobbs to what we see from the Oregon Ducks at the collegiate level, a team that runs a high-tempo spread offense with some passing, some running ability, pressuring the opposing defense with their tempo, but then that in turn helps the aggressiveness of their defense.
3rd down and 4, last drive for Grambling ended with a 3-and-out. Southern threatening to do it again. Jaguars bring 4. Williams with time. Catch. Throwing it on time, and that's a 1st down. Grambling gain of 6.
Chris Brazil coming in at the tight end position. Now he's rotating out, bringing more receivers, more playmakers, more speed onto the field for this Tigers offense.
Justin Kelly, the tailback, right up the middle, tough running to the 37-yard line. Kelly picks up 6 yards before he's brought down by Deontay McDuffie.
Kelly was a starter his freshman year back in 2013. And once they got different players in there, especially guys like Martez Carter, he's had to share the load of the running game. As you referenced earlier, Paul, Jonathan Williams, even last season throughout the whole year, was their leading ball carrier.
Kelly once again hit just as he got to the 35-yard line, gains two, and that's McDuffie again for the second consecutive play. So Grambling ought to be pretty comfortable, even though they want to be, but trailing by 17. If you look back at their signature win this season, which came October 17th against defending champion Alcorn State, they trailed 28-14 before coming back to win in overtime. Third down and two, back to the ground game, and they pick up the first. 3 yards and a Tiger first down.
Now that the first down has been attained for Grambling, this is where they usually try to get the tempo going that much more. We've seen inconsistency from the tempo of Grambling throughout the first half.
Jonathan Williams' journey to the starting quarterback position really started late last September. Brought the Tigers from behind in that game. He's been the starting quarterback ever since. Looking deep here. Got his man. What a throw. And the ball goes to the ground after the catch was made. Kejandre Domino. Gain of 46.
They tend to like to put Kejandre Domino in the slot position to the wide side of the field. Finds him one-on-one matchups in that way. Excellent pass from Jonathan Williams. Drops it over the outstretched shoulder.
The Tigers started that drive leaning heavily on the run, and they get him deep. Perfectly placed by Williams.
Potential they'll take another look at this play.
Southern University has called their first charge timeout. It'll be a 30-second timeout. Timeout.
The first big play at Grambling offense, and it looked like Domino had it for about 3 steps there, Anthony. Secures it. And when he goes to the ground, the ball comes out immediately.
Agreed. This is one of the plays that we've seen maybe overanalyzed in the National Football League to the point where officials seem to call it inconsistently. Overall, at the collegiate level, that's usually a catch, and I don't think that's something that, even with the timeout and an opportunity for the officials to take another look at it, I don't see that one as being something that would or should be overturned. But it was the big play that brought Grambling back into the game last season as well, where Southern had gotten out to a 14-point lead a couple of different times earlier in the game. Big plays in special teams and huge plays in the passing game led Grambling back in. And that's really who they are. Roger Phipps talks about that old Nolan Richardson sort of approach from his Arkansas basketball days at 40 minutes of hell, the tempo, the aggressiveness.
First down and goal coming up to the 5-yard line with an inside pitch. Southern defense was there and ready. That's a loss. Loss of 1 yard, tackle made by Jamar Mitchell. Penalty marker on the play.
See the little toss up into the air as Chad Williams is coming in motion. They do that just in case the ball ends up on the ground. They can call it an incompletion as opposed to a fumble.
Personal foul, number 98 on a hit on the quarterback. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Outside linebacker Daniel Brown called for that foul.
It's one of the things that Dawson Odoms talks about with Daniel Brown, the ability to maintain his composure, keep his emotions in check from time to time.
So now it's first down and goal from the 3. Tigers trailing 20-3. Justin Kelly tries it up the middle, gets 1. there for Southern, Javon Allen.
Big number 90 in the middle, Gabe Eccles hitting blocks. It's going to be hard duty for the Grambling offense down here. Just a couple of yards to go before the end zone to move Eccles out of there.
Roderick Fobbs, the tailback for Eddie Robinson from 92 to 95, sees his quarterback put it on the ground. And how about that? Just how you draw it up. Kejandre Domino with the touchdown.
One of the terms that Roderick Fobbs uses for his offense is basketball on grass. So Jonathan Williams took it a step further. He dribbled the football to himself in the backfield and then delivered an absolute strike to the front corner to Domino.
Excellent presence by Williams. The snap came early, almost dropped it on the snap, and then he did drop it. Gathered it and found Domino. What a drive for number one, who had two catches.
Timeout.
One for 46 yards. And the other for a touchdown. Grambling needed that. 8:24 left. The Southern lead is cut in half. Williams to Domino. Sunday night is football night. We'll be in Denver for America's Game of the Week as Tom Brady and his unbeaten Patriots take on Brock Osweiler and the Broncos. Your hosts for Football Night in America, Bob Costas and Dan Patrick. It all begins at 7 o'clock Eastern, 4 Pacific, only on NBC. Good-looking shot. New Orleans there. We are inside the Superdome. Paul Burmeister, Anthony Heron in the booth. Lewis Johnson on the sideline, and a couple of offenses heating up on the field. Southern Jaguars, they've won three of their last four games. 20-10 lead over the Grambling Tigers. Come into this one having won eight in a row. Pooch kick once again to keep it away from Willie Quinn, who has five return touchdowns already this year. The Jaguars lead by 10.
Watch Sunday Night Football on NBC.
Welcome back to the Superdome, the 42nd annual Bayou Classic. Southern leads by 10. Race the Movie is based on the incredible true story of Jesse Owens, and it stars Stephen James, coming to theaters February of 2016.
I don't trust naturals. I will say, you can run. Boy, oh boy, you can jump. What I want to know is, can you win? So here we go. Here.
Have a problem, Coach?
No.
You want me to do it again?
Yeah.
And I am here with Canadian-born starring actor Stephon James. And, you know, this role really has so many important storylines. Tell me about the mental approach you took to attack such an important character.
I mean, anytime you're playing somebody as legendary, as epic as the great Jesse Owens, you gotta put yourself into that state, into that mind state. What was it like for him as an athlete in 1936 and as a black man in 1936? So that's where I approached it.
Now, what about the physical side of this? Because obviously he was a great sprinter, a long jumper. How did you physically get ready for this role?
It's so funny, actually. I was shooting a film called Selma at the time.
Yes.
And on my off days on Selma, I would just go down to Georgia State and train with the coaches there, the track and field coaches at Georgia State. So, I had to learn not only how to run fast, but to run like Jesse, from his start to his stride to his finish to his facial expression. So it was a process for me.
And to be in that stadium there in Berlin where all the history took place, I know you guys shot a lot there. What was that like?
Oh, I got chills. I got chills walking into the stadium in Berlin for the first time. And you know, for me, it was almost like channeling Jesse Owens and walking into that stadium, nearly 80 years ago.
Race hits theaters February 19th. Make sure you go see it. Stephon James, an up-and-coming actor from Canada. Great job in that role. Looking forward to seeing it. And best of luck the rest of your career, all right?
I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
All right. Looking forward to seeing that, Paul.
Yeah, Lewis, how about that for an assignment for Stephon? Just go run like Jesse Owens. That's easy, right?
Oh, he was also in the movie Selma. Did an outstanding job in that role as well. Up-and-coming young actor, as Lewis referenced there.
Willie Quinn now six catches, that one good for 11 yards and a Southern first down. Hey, good news for Grambling and all their fans out there. They did get that offense going, mix a run and pass and scored a touchdown the last drive, but they have yet to really slow down the Southern offense. They've ended each of the three drives with a touchdown, and they're on the move right now. There's Leonard Tillery around the right side. First down, gain of 13.
You see some of that fast twitch on display from Bernard Tillery. He's improved as a ball carrier throughout his career. And again, in that pistol set, it's got to be a run key for the Tigers defense. He's improved as a ball carrier with his willingness to run downhill. Early in his career, he looked to make moves, bounce things outside, but he really didn't need to.
You can do that, the play action to Tillery, and look deep to Mike Jones. And that's exactly what the Grambling defense needed. Interception by Nicholas Peoples. Well, Austin Howard had gone the last seven games without throwing an interception.
Timeout.
Had 15 touchdown passes in that time. But the Tiger defense said no more. Nicholas Peoples with the INT, and the Tiger offense will be back on the field right after this.
Focus your eyes towards the top left of the screen on the 30-yard line where Nicholas Peoples is playing center field for this Tigers secondary. Depth at the safety position has been an issue for Grambling the last two seasons. Throughout this year, we've seen them get more depth to have zone eyes in the backfield. And for the second consecutive season, Nick Peoples picks off Austin Howard. This time, almost took it to the house.
Grambling offense back on the field. The last drive, Williams was 3 out of 3. Buys a little extra time and picks up a first down with his feet and then some. Jonathan Williams picks up 25.
Here's where we see tempo and momentum picking up for the Grambling Tigers. Big plays made offensively, leading to plays being made defensively, and now their offense comes on, trying to impose their will using the tempo.
They scored 45 points in this game last year. Harbinger, what was to come this year? They're averaging 44 points, and they're on the move on this drive. Chester Rogers for 13, brought down by Martin Henry.
One of the players that have great ball skills on the outside. We've seen him make acrobatic grabs throughout his career.
Martez guarded the tailback, the one averaging 8.6 yards per carry this year. Williams keeps it himself, flips it out to his left. Another Grambling first down inside the 5-yard line. That's Chester Rogers again. Goes around the right side, then to the left for 13.
That's the new age triple option. It's a big part of this Grambling offense. Fake the give in the middle, then Williams threatens the edge of the defense. He's got a throw option outside the numbers. We saw him utilize it there.
Guarded the tailback to the left of Williams on first down and goal from just inside the 5. Carter cuts it back and picks up 1. Simeon Houston with a tackle for Southern.
It's good to see a willingness to run it inside just to kind of keep the defense honest there, but that's not going to be the best opportunity for Grambling today to gain yards. This defensive front for Southern just plays at such a high level. They hit blocks and allow the linebackers to roam.
The tailback, Martez Carter, leads the Southwestern Athletic Conference with 15 total touchdowns. This is second and goal. Williams with time. Fires it incomplete, maybe a little bit too much to yeah. Chris Bazile.
Arm talent from Jonathan Williams. He threw a hot one there that just sailed, just zoomed over the head of Bazile. He's a diminutive guy, but it doesn't take much. He's just got that boogie whip action in his shoulder.
Broke Williams' streak of 4 consecutive completions going back to the last drive, which was Grambling's first touchdown drive of the afternoon. Third down and goal coming. Carter to the right of Williams and 3 wideouts to his right. Touchdown, Tigers! Williams to Verlin Hunter.
We saw last season that Merlin Hunter tends to save his best for the Bayou Classic. Had a huge game last season, not coming up again today with the touchdown that gets the Graham fam right back in this game.
As a quarterback, they always tell you if you get in trouble down near the end zone, look to work the back of the end zone. Hunter kept working. Williams bought a little extra time, spotted him in the back, fired a strike. And we've got a ball game in the 42nd Bayou Classic. And we are happy to have a three-point ball game here in the 42nd Bayou Classic. Moments ago, it was 20-3. The Bayou Classic offense right now that's hot belongs to the Grambling Tigers. Two consecutive drives ending in touchdowns. Big boost from the defense, ending the last Southern offense drive with an interception. This time they can't keep it away from Willie Quinn, but the Grambling special teams, nice job of bringing him down. Tackle made by Dre Fusler.
And now we'll get to see the response from Southern's offense as Willie Quinn is a bit gimpy getting off the field. But they've got the temperament to be able to do this because of the fact that they use the run game so frequently. So they can change the tempo of the game just by getting the football to Lennard Tillery. As we referenced earlier, though, this run defense from Grambling has been the best in the SWAC throughout the season.
There's Quinn going down hard. And that run defense that you mentioned, Anthony, that had been number one in the conference coming into this game, holding the conference leading rusher, Lennard Tillery, 5 carries, only 28 yards. Tillery on the sidelines watching it, Malcolm Crockett get this possession started the right way for the Jaguars by picking up 7. Tackle made by Troy Roach.
It's a good 1-2 combination they have. Malcolm Crockett become a bigger and bigger role as part of the run game here in recent weeks. Especially on senior day, went over 100 yards for the first time this season a couple of weeks back.
Austin Howard and the Jaguar offense had gone the first 3 drives, ending each one with a touchdown, until the 4th it ended with a Nicholas Peoples interception. Crockett again fighting for extra yards, picks up 5, and also picks up a Jaguar first down. Tackle made by Arquez Cooper.
Defense getting the rest. Offense just landing a couple of body blows here. The mistake that was made was off of play action, hoping to get the safety to bite. On the last drive, Nicholas Peoples from the safety position just baited Austin Howard into delivering that football into traffic.
See how Howard responds to throwing his first interception since game number 3. There's a strike there. Southern now working inside of Grambling territory. That's a gain of 5.
Well, Lennard Tillery, as you referenced, Paul, hasn't had a huge imprint on the game so far today. He's a team guy. You know, Dawson Odoms talks about that consistently, the work effort that he puts into it as a former walk-on, but the all-time leading rusher for the Jaguars.
Has scored a touchdown today and wasn't touched on that run until he was deep in the Tiger defensive backfield. Picks up 18 before he's finally brought down by Guy Stallworth.
Love watching the way this offensive line works together for Southern, because it's usually either zone blocking going to one side, or you'll see one of the interior blockers, the center or the two guards, pulling together out in space. It takes a lot of cohesion to get your group of big fellas doing that consistently.
First down and 10. Back to the ground game. This is Crockett. At the corner for a moment. Run out of bounds by Amphi. Picks up 4.
That's what you have to have. When your big men up front can change the tide of a ball game for you, and you can impose your will on the opponent. So right now, Grambling's defense seems to have very little answer for how to combat the run game of Southern.
Run game flexing its muscles right here. The 1-2 punch at Tillery and Crockett. Crockett heads to the sideline. The conference number one rusher comes in. Tillery back in. On second down, 4. Howard with the play action. And the completion inside the 5-yard line. The ball is fumbled at the end of the play. And Grambling has it. Jaxarius Pouncey pounces on the fumble. There is an injured Tiger on the play.
It appears to be the biggest playmaking linebacker, Arquez Cooper. Secondary coming in, not able to secure the tackle, but then the ball pops out. And that rallying to the football makes such a difference when you've got bodies around the football, chasing the ball carrier snap after snap. It requires so much energy, but it's worth it when you can get moments like this.
Mike Roach, the Tiger that knocked that ball out. Right there.
That's just an outstanding job. The effort that it takes and then to come in and execute, raking away at the football when you're not in position. It's Arquez Cooper being helped off the field under his own power. Good to see that. But the effort it takes to chase the football down and then put yourself in position to actually rake it out when you can't get your body squared up for a clean tackle.
That was Nico Talbert, number 6, who fumbled it and gave it away to Grambling. And that is now 2 consecutive possessions that have ended with a Southern turnover. No real surprise to watch the Grambling defense take it away. They came into this game number 1 in the SWAC in takeaways with 29. Justin Kelly, the tailback. Right up the middle, getting some of that room back for Jonathan Williams, and also getting a Grambling first down with a gain of 15. Tackle made by Deontay McDuffie. Grambling hurry up offense now at the 2-minute mark of the second quarter. Williams across the middle, another first down. Chris Bazile picks up 17. Brought down by Kentavious Preston.
You think about Jonathan Williams as a 5'11 quarterback throwing out of the tunnel, and to have the ability to do that from within the pocket, finding throwing lanes that he can still get it through to.
140 and counting now. Tigers on the move. They score touchdowns on 2 consecutive possessions. Nice pocket to step into. And that's exactly how it's supposed to look. Williams to Hunter for 16.
You referenced the nice pocket there, Paul. This pass rush from Southern, now that the tide of this game has been turning and Grambling for multiple drives now, has gotten the tempo going in their favor. It's made a difference. It's now affecting
Grambling
the defensive front and the energy they can rush the quarterback with.
30 second timeout.
127 left, first down and 10. Grambling down 20-17. Ease on down the road to Oz and the holiday event of the season. The Wiz Live, starring Queen Latifah, Mary J. Blige, Common, and more, brings the Tony Award-winning musical to television in a live production airing this Thursday, 8 and 7 Central on NBC. And be sure to tune in to halftime for a Wiz-inspired surprise.
DVR set, Paul. DVR is set for that one. The Wiz Live, yes. I'm as excited about that. I mean, NBC's been doing these live stage performances for a few years now. This is the one I've been most excited about.
Jonathan Williams. He was ready. Not on the proverbial same page. As we get ready for the Battle of Vans, you can watch it live here coming up at halftime at the 42nd Bayou Classic.
The human jukebox.
Got to get stretched out, limbered up.
So it would appear that there's going to be either some Matrix-style performing or, you know, some lean back. We will see. Whatever it's going to be, we know it's going to be a show.
Jaguars only been 3. Plenty of time. And Williams couldn't connect with Chester Rogers. However, Dawson Odoms has watched the Grambling quarterback begin 3 out of 8, and since he is now 8 out of 11.
He's finding creases in the secondary. That's where Grambling likes to operate, getting behind the defenses, threatening them deep. It opens up some of the shorter passing lanes. Before a guy who's only 5'11", and I'm really not confident Jonathan Williams is actually 5'11 anyway, but let's say he is. Let's say he's 5'11", still a bit diminutive in stature for a quarterback. So to be able to throw the deeper ball tends to suit his stature that much more from a vision standpoint.
Grambling State has called
Williams
third,
calls timeout here. 1:16 left.
30-second timeout.
His Tigers trailing by three.
We've seen the progression of Jonathan Williams throughout his career. As you referenced earlier, Paul, he was not the starter early in his career. While this is the third consecutive Bayou Classic that he started, but he's had to compete with DJ Williams, the son of former Grambling coach Doug Williams. He's had to be behind other players as well. Steven Johnson, you know, he was actually the third string quarterback for a couple of years, just trying to work his way into the lineup. And now we've seen just season by season, Jonathan Williams grab a hold of the position of quarterback. And now in the second season that he's played under Broderick Bobbs, now really grab a leadership role. We see him admonishing his teammates at different points, and they have rallied around him as the main playmaker.
Has thrown more touchdown passes than every quarterback in the SWAC. Including this game, has thrown two in every single game in the last nine. And remember, they came into this game on an eight-game winning streak. Putting up those numbers after he started 3 out of 8. Those are easy. Well, I said easy, and it turns out all right for the Grambling offense. Catching it the second time is Chad Williams. Still picks up 14 yards before he's brought down by McDonald.
The defender's in position to make the tackle.
A little spike, stop the clock, 1:03 left to bring up second down 10. I see the Jaguars on this entire drive, Anthony, rushing only three. That secondary could really use some help. You look at the last seven games, 7.5 including this one. Opposing quarterbacks have thrown 16 touchdowns to only three picks.
Mark Orozco, one of the top kickers in the SWAC, getting his leg warm. Hit a 40-yarder in this game last year.
Williams had time initially, then kept it himself. Picks up one. Clock now ticking, 51-50 and counting.
Grambling not getting too helter-skelter on third down with the clock running.
No timeouts left for the Tigers either. Still only three rushers. He failed to get any pressure on Williams. The first down gain of 11. Big hit by McDuffie. But the Tigers on the move now inside the 25-yard line. Again, no timeouts left. Now with 20 seconds left until halftime.
If the officials over the ball.
Well, they lost 12 seconds there. Took them, Jonathan Williams, a while to get up and get that one spiked. So 10 ticks left, Anthony. You're probably thinking one play. Take a shot at the end zone.
And there's enough time where that one play can be just short of the end zone as long as it is beyond the first down marker.
Grambling. The penalty also called. A 10-second subtraction.
So now delay of game has apparently been called on Grambling.
The half has ended.
That's a 10-second runoff here. The final minute of the half.
So they had a little over 20 seconds after that completion to get up there. And those, all those seconds ticked down. They got to that 10.
And I'm really not clear on the clock management of the officials there, because the first down that was taken very briefly stopped the clock. And then the umpire stepped in to stop the offense before they were able to snap it. The clock was continuing to run at that point. But I'm really not confident that clock situation there at the end of the first half was managed properly by the officials.
There they are, 22 seconds and counting. The game clock on the left stayed at zero.
For Broderick Fobbs.
So that's upset. That counts as confusion to end the half, and it counts against Broderick Fobbs and his Tigers, and a chance to take a shot at the end zone or to kick a field goal. They trail 20-17, and Fobbs still looking for an answer.
hopefully they will be able to explain it, because I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not certain the officials handled the clock correctly there myself either. Halftime is a bit extended, so Broderick Fobbs will get an opportunity. And so it's the play clock on the left that ticked down there. The game clock still had 10 seconds remaining by the time they actually went in and called the penalty. Well, they ended up calling a delay of game. That led to the 10-second runoff.
Let's go down to Lewis Johnson.
All right, let's see if we can get an answer on this. Coach, you just had a discussion with the referee. What did he tell you?
Well, he told me that we didn't snap the ball in time, and since it was a delay of game, it's a 10-second runoff. So I didn't see the clock, so I guess it was a delay of game penalty, so there's nothing we can do about it now.
You were asking for your quarterback to spike, and then the referee came up, right? And is that correct?
Definitely, but hey, we can't do anything about it now. We just got to go and regroup. We played a poor first quarter, but we played a better second quarter. We got to play better in third and fourth.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
All right.
Lewis, Coach, thank you. Coming up in a few moments, we'll see both school bands, the Battle of the Bands. They also will perform songs from the musical The Wiz. For two brothers in the Southern Band, their journey here is simply remarkable.
So I have three children with autism. Daniel was diagnosed at 3. Micah was diagnosed in 6th grade, but he was also diagnosed with central auditory processing delay. So he has kind of like a double whammy. As he started growing up, he had no language. So he didn't talk. He was really quiet. He liked his own thing. He was in his own world. And then Josiah was diagnosed in 4th grade. Josiah had no language until about 3, so he started talking earlier. Because I love music, I thought this would be fun to get them engaged in band. I said, look, mommy loved band. Let's try it, you know. Let's see if you guys will like it. I really think music kind of opened up their minds.
Music is almost like, it's more of a second nature thing. Like in every day you would like get up, get dressed and whatnot. Music is like that for me. The way the chords are played and the way the melodies are played, it's like walking on the bridge from one side to the other, traveling from world to world, one place to another. So it's like an adventure.
The Southern University Marching Band from Jaguar Land. The Southern University Marching Band is led by drum major Keith the Dream Morgan from New Orleans, Louisiana. Show him some love. ladies and gentlemen, the Human Jukebox would like to remind you to tune in on Thursday, December the 3rd on NBC to Fuel the Wiz. The Southern University Marching Band would like to pay tribute to our newly elected governor, John Bell Edwards. Congratulations, Governor Edwards. The tune is called Stanley. Moving at 360 steps per minute.
To see more on the Frank Brothers story, we invite you to go to NBCNews.com. Back inside the Superdome with the Grambling Band right after this.
Your attention on the flexible acrobatic loose-limbed leaders of the blueprint of marching band excellence. From New Iberia, Louisiana, Mike, it's Showtime Bradley. And from the nation's capital, Jalen Finesse Hawkins. Drum majors, bend, but don't break, baby. It is the most sensational, inspirational, devastatingly dynamic marching music machine known to man. Small children, point and proclaim with glee, Mama, there goes that band. In France, they say, Le Monde Célèbre. In Spain, El Mundo Famoso. But all around the world, they know our name. We are meticulously maneuvers the pinpoint preciseness of its precision drill. We'd like to salute our First Lady of Football, Mrs. Doris Robinson. under the expert tutelage of Mrs. Diane Maroney Grigsby. It is the breathtakingly beautiful, gorgeously graceful Orchesis Dance Company to Cameo's Word Up. If you are looking for the best band in the land, all you gotta do is ease on down the road to Tigerland.
Inside the Superdome here in New Orleans, 42nd annual Bayou Classic. Halftime coming to a close. Southern leading 20-17. Early in the second quarter, the Jaguars led 20-3. Grambling scored the final 14 points of the first half, and we are moments away from the beginning of the third quarter. Get you back inside the Superdome for quarters 3 and 4 right after this. Welcome back inside the Superdome. Paul Burmeister and Anthony Herron in the broadcast booth. Lewis Johnson on the field, and lots of offense on the field during that first half. And it all started with the Southern Jaguars. On their first possession, they went right down the field, scored with really only took a minute 45 off the clock. That's Howard to Quinn, and there's your first touchdown.
Willie Quinn wide open in the secondary. Next drive comes up, and Lenard Tillery able to feed the ball into the end zone behind it. Big blockers up front.
Austin Howard's been a big part of the game plan for Southern, not only with the efficiency through the air, tough running for a touchdown. And how about this one? Jonathan Williams drops it, picks it up, fires a touchdown to Domino.
That really seemed to get the Tigers going, not only offensively, but defensively as well. Nick Biegbols able to bait Austin Howard into an interception off play action in the end zone, and then defense turning to offense for Grambling. Berlin Hunter, that was the score that put them right back in this ball game.
And Williams now, those two fingers could mean at least two touchdown passes in all of their last 9 games in each one. And they trailed 20-3 at one point, and now it's 20-17. Tigers getting ready. Let's go to the field and check in with Lewis Johnson.
Well, Dawson Odoms was rather frustrated when he left the field in the first half. They were up 20-3. They had the 2 turnovers, and then he was trying to figure out where all the momentum and energy went as he went back into the locker room. And he said that he wanted to make sure that his players understood that they wanted to close out this regular season on a great note. They've got to figure out a way to kind of regroup. Now for Grambling and Broderick Frobbs, he saw his team really respond in the second quarter, and now the question is, how do they finish? Earlier in the week, he told us that they look at themselves as a cheetah or a lion, and those two animals are never loud, they're never boisterous, and they don't make much noise, but they're focused and they know they have to eat, so they go in for the kill. So Fobbs said, for our program to take the next steps to those next levels, we have to remain focused, dominant, and go after our prey. And so, guys, Southern is the prey with a half to go in this Bayou Classic.
Lewis Southern was the prey with a 20-3 lead early in that second quarter, and it's been all about Jonathan Williams getting hot during that second quarter. Also, big stat on the stat sheet there, Anthony. Two turnovers created by Grambling, and that's something they've done very well all season. Came in leading the conference in that category. And Southern kind of had its way offensively with Roderick Bob's defense in the first quarter, and it really changed with those turnovers in the second quarter.
It's interesting when you look at the matchup between these two teams, because especially the last couple of years where the programs have been back at a prominent level as far as their execution on the field, last season's game and this season's game, where Southern steps out early, multiple score lead, and it's really the turnovers, the takeaways for Grambling. And then last season there were special teams plays that turned the tide as well. The kicking game for Grambling this season much stronger than what we've seen throughout the season for Southern. So if this game stays tight late, kicking advantage, I would say, goes to the Tigers.
I also back up to a kicking miscue really early in the game, Anthony. I mentioned that Southern went down to score in less than 2 minutes into the game. They missed that extra point, and that's why their lead is only three. We'll see how much of a factor that 1 point becomes as the third quarter turns into the fourth. Grambling, 8 consecutive wins coming into this game. They've already punched their ticket to the SWAC conference title game next weekend in Houston. Southern looking to finish its season with 4 wins in its final 5 games and a 4th consecutive over Grambling. The Grambling offense will begin from its own 35-yard line, and Roderick Bob certainly hopes that his quarterback Jonathan Williams begins where he left off in that second quarter. First quarter, slow start. He was only 3 out of 8 for 22 yards. And in that second quarter, 10 out of 13, 141 yards, 2 touchdowns. And while he didn't throw an interception, his counterpart, Austin Howard, did throw one. And his play, plus those turnovers, big reason why they only trail by 3. Kelly, the tailback, around the right side, out to the 39-yard line. He picks up 5 before he's brought down by McDuffie.
The lost yards that are gained by offenses in the read option are because the quarterback is able to become more of a runner, more of a ball carrier. And since we saw those 55 rushing yards in the first half for Jonathan Williams, that's where Justin Kelly, Martez Carter really started to get more yardage for themselves.
Second 5, quick pitch outside to Chad Williams. Nice job of keeping his feet. Fights his way out to the 43-yard line, picks up 3. And that'll bring up 3rd and short. Tackle made by Tiller.
This would be a big stop because the momentum at the end of the first half certainly favored Grambling State. Southern's defense can come out here and get the ball punted back to their offense.
Grambling converted 4 out of 7 third downs in the first down during that first half to the air. Williams buys some extra time and fires incomplete. So it took a couple of extra counts, but the Jaguar rush finally got to Williams and forced that incomplete pass.
And his pocket presence has improved a lot from where he was earlier in his career. This was a situation where he didn't really need to leave the pocket, but he wanted to get it to Kajandre Domino, and so he started to evacuate the pocket. But coverage was there in position and nowhere for him to look and find a way to deliver the football.
A big stop by the Jaguar defense, because remember, in that second quarter, penalty marker comes out. Second quarter, Grambling scored in a couple of consecutive possessions.
Running into the kicker. Number 9 on the defense. 5-yard penalty results of the foul. First down.
Running into the kicker against the Southern special teams.
There's at least some acting involved here.
Ooh.
He clipped that plant leg.
Dawson Odoms wants to have a conversation
about how much acting. The previous foul.
Now, either way, Grambling has the football.
Number 9, 5 yards.
Big turn of events. The defense for Southern had stepped up. And a special teams penalty puts the Grambling offense right back on the field. First down and 10 from their own 47. Williams to Domino, had a touchdown earlier. That's incomplete. And it'll be second down 10.
That's bad presence of mind there from Kajandre Domino. It should be an easy throw and catch. Jonathan Williams looked off the coverage, threw the ball short. Domino's got to know where the sideline is and stay in bounds. It keeps your offense on rhythm. It wouldn't have been a big gain, but it just gets a rhythm going off that first down.
Side give to Kelly, untouched until he gets inside that 45-yard line right at the first down mark. Gain of 11. Brought down by Danny Johnson.
We're not seeing big tempo here starting the third quarter for Grambling. I'm honestly a bit surprised by that because it was in the second quarter, once they really got some tempo going, that they seemed to be able to move the ball more effectively.
Let's call that a gain of 10 as they come out to get a measurement. Be a few inches short. So, Anthony, I mentioned during that first half a couple of times that the Southern defense came in with the top two sackers in the conference, and Aaron Tiller and Daniel Brown haven't called their name much, and really we've seen Jonathan Williams with all kinds of time the majority of his drops.
The edge rushers, when you've got a quarterback that's as mobile as Jonathan Williams, if you don't get home on those rushes the first few times, you can start to lose aggressiveness. Tiller's coming off a game. We had four sacks just a couple of weeks ago on senior day. Brown has been that consistent force off the opposite edge throughout the season as a senior.
Third down and inches coming up for Jonathan Williams and the Grambling offense. Justin Kelly is the tailback to his left.
I see this as two down territory from this field position. Wouldn't surprise me if maybe there's a play action, a pass attempt here with the thought of potentially going for fourth down.
Give it to Kelly. First down and then some, drag down just as he crossed that 35-yard line. Tiller brought him down, but not before he picked up 10 yards.
A more methodical drive than you normally see from the Grambling Tigers. The big back, Justin Kelly, has had a big imprint on this game in the third quarter.
Much more so than Martez Carter, number four, who came into this game as Grambling's top rusher. Williams keeps it himself under pressure. Does a nice job of holding that to no gain. Martin Henry providing the pressure for Southern.
We saw that same sort of triple option look in the first half. It's easier to execute to the wide side of the field where Williams can use his legs and continue to bait the defense in to honor him.
Second down nine, Williams to his right. Tries to cut it back. Good strength to get across the 30-yard line and pick up four. And that'll bring up third down and five, brought down by Preston.
Okay, man, anticipating the pass protection from Southern would be really impressive, but the pass protection for Grambling has been effective as well against this defensive front. You saw Justin Kelly, the back, able to chop down Daniel Brown off the edge. Being the defensive end on the turf, that gave the corner to Jonathan Williams.
Williams, couple of touchdown passes in that first half. Facing third down and five now. Leaves the pocket, sprinting to that first down mark and doesn't quite get there. Pursuing for the Jaguar defense, Kentavious Preston chasing him out of bounds. The gain between 4 and 5 yards. Reached that ball out at the end for a first. Didn't quite get there.
With this being fourth and short, this is more of a decision, as actually there's a Southern player down at the second level, the Jaguars defense.
It's Nicholas McDonald, defensive back, a junior from right here in New Orleans.
This area of the field, there's more of a decision for Broderick Fobbs to make because he does have a kicker who he has confidence in. And Marco Rosco, or if it were Dawson Odoms, I think it would be more certain that he would attempt this fourth down. It does appear that Fobbs will leave his offense onto the field. Field goal would tie the game at this point.
Tigers right now 1 out of 1 converting fourth down. Tailback joining Jonathan Williams in the backfield, Justin Kelly. Fourth down and less than a yard.
Grambling State has called their first charge timeout in the second half. 30-second timeout.
Timeout called by Grambling.
I wonder if the timeout coming from some indecision from Broderick Fobbs and his coaching staff, wondering whether or not they should go for the fourth down. I don't see any discussion as our cameras sort of peer into the huddle of Grambling that would make me think they are going to run Mark Orozco onto the field.
You like the call?
I don't like using the timeout in that situation. I do like them going for the fourth down just because the tempo, the pace of this ball game would certainly indicate that touchdowns will be more necessary moving forward than field goals, especially if we're taking last season into account and all the fireworks that we saw in the second half.
A game that ended 52-45. Dawson Odom's Jaguars found a way to win that shootout. And ever since the second quarter started, it seems like the Grambling offense has been making some money right up the middle with those dives on the read option. And Jonathan Williams, a number of times, has had plenty of real estate around the right and the left side when he keeps it. See what the Southern defense can do now on fourth and less than a yard. And there's Kelly picking up that first down right up the middle, gains three. Simeon Houston makes the tackle.
240 pounds of Justin Kelly. This junior hasn't had a running lane every time.
Williams sets up and fires behind Chester Rogers.
There's moments like that where Jonathan Williams appears to have an opportunity to set a better throwing platform when he's not really under pressure from the defensive front. But he's so quick, not just his arm action, but his footwork in the pocket, where he resets. And it looks like maybe he can just take another half measure and really get himself set with balance to deliver an accurate pass.
12th play of this drive coming up. Top two receivers for Grambling, Chad Williams and Chester Rogers, been pretty quiet so far. The ground game has been strong. Martez Carter picks up 20.
Throughout the drive so far, they've been using Justin Kelly as the thunder. There's Martez Carter, the sophomore, showing us some lightning.
Already has 15 touchdowns. Williams with a cut and dives into the end zone.
For the first time, under the leadership of Broderick Fobbs, the Grambling State Tigers take a lead in the Bayou Classic. Fakes out to the wide side of the field. He only needed a yard.
Jonathan Williams, two touchdown passes this afternoon, now with a touchdown run.
Timeout.
What was a 20-3 Southern lead is now a 24-20 Grambling advantage. The Bayou Classic on NBCSN is brought to you by Coors Light, official sponsor of HBCU Classics for over 25 years. Last year we had a real classic, 52-45, down to the last play, Southern won. 10:45 left in the third quarter, not going to call it a classic yet, but we have the makings of a very good game. 24-20, 21 consecutive points scored by Grambling after they trailed 20-3. See if Willie Quinn gets a chance here for his sixth return touchdown of the season. He does not. This is Mike Jones out to the 40.
Well, we referenced earlier Robert Fobbs, an alum of Grambling State University, who took this program over last season. They'd had two total wins during the 2012 and 2013 seasons. Program went from Doug Williams to very briefly George Ragsdale to Dennis Durton Linston as a head coach, finishing out 2013. They brought Broderick Fobbs back home to Grambling and immediately turned the program around. So you know, while there's a lot of coach speak, and we hear him down there talking to Lewis Johnson, and he says the right things about what this game means.
but you know inside of him burns that desire to get this win, get this first Bayou Classic victory for his Tigers program.
But artillery met right as he got to the line of scrimmage. Latarius Pouncey, the first Tiger there.
Austin Howard really played well in the first half. Used his legs, threw the ball effectively. Had the one mistake where he threw into coverage, and Nicholas Peoples did make him pay for it. And that level of efficiency that he plays the quarterback position with certainly aided by the way that they've been able to run the football over the last couple of seasons with Lenard Tillery.
Play action to Tillery. Lots of pressure on Howard. Haven't seen much of that yet.
Yeah.
Forced that incompletion to bring up third down.
Look at who's got a pass rush all of a sudden. Grambling has a lead in the game. First lead they've had in the Bayou Classic for a couple of years. Now we see this defensive front starting to get after the quarterback. Artez Cooper coming off the edge, prowling his way into the backfield.
The Southern offense wants to reverse the recent fortunes. If you remember, early in the game, the first three possessions all ended in touchdowns. The last two possessions, both turnovers. One interception and one fumble. Now they face third down and eight.
Look at that prowling. Fainting into the A-gap, dropping in coverage.
They drop eight into coverage. Still Howard flushed out, keeps it himself. And that's not going to be enough for a first.
From the linebacker position, we use that term prowling, the stem and disguise that they use from the LBs. And so as a quarterback, you're not sure where the protection is going to come from. Arcaz Cooper was in there for a moment, then he drops out. Derwin Butler in the A-gap for a moment, then he drops out. You don't know how many are rushing, how many are dropping. And so it puts not the physical pressure, that hasn't been consistent throughout the game, but as much as that, this Grambling defense puts mental pressure on the pass protection.
Sean McClain back deep to receive for Grambling. Remember, on that last drive where Grambling went down, they were punting away as well, but Southern called for running into the kicker, kept the drive alive. And now the defense steps up. And the ball will come right back to Jonathan Williams after they just scored on a 13-play drive. 9:23 left in the third quarter, and Grambling on top by four. The late, great Eddie Robinson started to put the plan in motion for the Bayou Classic back in 1955 when Grambling played Florida A&M in front of 48,000 at the Orange Bowl. He wanted that kind of atmosphere and kind of event here in Louisiana. Didn't happen until 1973. Convinced Southern their annual season-ending game should be played in Shreveport. They did it there 1 year. 41,000 wasn't big enough. They moved it to Tulane Stadium in 74. That wasn't big enough. It's been inside the Superdome ever since. The rest is Bayou Classic history. Current Tiger head coach Broderick Fobbs played for Eddie Robinson 1992 to 1995. Martez Carter, big gain on the last scoring drive. Wrapped up that time by Aaron Tiller. And I think Eddie Robinson would be proud of how his offense has responded after falling down 20-3. They've rattled off 21 consecutive points.
You speak to Broderick Fobbs about Eddie Robinson. There's a lot of the catchphrases that he used, the mantras that he tries to impart upon his team. Everything for him goes back to Coach Rob.
Pressure on Williams. Eludes it. So we've seen that a number of times now in the second half, that they don't actually bring Williams to the ground, but they are forcing the incompletion to him to just fire it away.
It's the pass rush momentarily, situationally, being able to heat up the pocket. Aaron Tiller, a very talented young pass rusher with a variety of moves. He can speed up the field. He can spin back inside. He can club and get you up the field. And Daniel Brown on the opposing edge. They have to have an imprint here.
Third down and 10. Nice pocket for Williams. And that pass broken up. Danny Johnson with the coverage.
Gabe Eccles, my guy. The big nose in the middle ends up leaking through late. Being able to get a hit on Jonathan Williams. When your big men are the ones leading the way, getting you back into the ball game, that's the way most teams prefer to operate.
Willie Quinn, 5 return touchdowns this year. Amazing stat. For a record 6th. Low punt.
I got to be honest, I'm disappointed.
I kind of wanted to see it myself.
Really wanted to see him get the football.
The Southern defense stepped up. 8:25 left in the third. He's like, I'll make it one sometime.
We are the...
Tomorrow morning, F1's stunning world tour comes to conclusion with the final race of the season. Abu Dhabi Grand Prix Live, tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock Eastern on NBCSN. 8:25 left in the 42nd annual Bayou Classic here inside the Louisiana Superdome. Southern led 20-3. Now they find themselves trailing. And in at quarterback is Jonte Schwartz. Austin Howard had been the quarterback. Schwartz hands off to Tillery for a gain of 5.
We'll see how long it ends up lasting. Jonte Schwartz in the lineup. He's played throughout the season, throughout the first couple of seasons of his career so far. Not nearly as effective a passer as what Austin Howard is.
Say not nearly, that's being kind. Only 10 out of 32 this year. No touchdowns. Tillery right up the middle, gains 2. Arquez Cooper there to stop him. And now we'll see how he does on 3rd down and 5.
There's times where Schwartz will start a series for the first couple of downs, and then if you get to 3rd and long, they'll just run Howard onto the field to handle the 3rd and long scenario. It does appear that Schwartz will be staying in the lineup.
With Howard in the lineup, the Jaguars 3 out of 7 converting on 3rd down. This is his first 3rd down situation is actually 3rd down and 3. Gives to the Jaguars' all-time leading rusher, Tillery, picks up 2, going to be a little bit short of that 1st down. Troy Roach, the first Tiger there.
I like the way this defensive front from Grambling is playing in the 3rd quarter. There's some aggressiveness down the hill from the linebackers also. It's a little jog going back and forth. The term sibling rivalry tends to get used by the two coaching staffs here, but just the sibling part, whether it's brother against brother or not, you want to beat them just the same.
It's like the Jaguars thought about it quite a bit. Now the play clock down inside of 5 seconds. You get the snap off to punt it right back to Grambling. Three plays with Jonte Schwartz, the quarterback for Southern. And they punt it right back to the Tigers. Just across the 10-yard line is where they'll begin. 6:20 left in the 3rd quarter. Tigers by 4.
Jamie wanted a taste of the real New Orleans. And we just...
Grambling's offensive coordinator, Eric Dooley. It's so fun to talk to him about this rivalry in particular because he's a guy... You've seen it from both sides. See Montez Carter getting the carry there, but Dooley's seen this rivalry from both sides. As a number of different coaches on the staff have. He played at Grambling State under Eddie Robinson, like some of the other assistants on the staff. Earned his master's degree from Southern and coached there as well. Now coming back to be the offensive coordinator for the Grambling Tigers. So he's one of the ones who adds that additional intensity from the coaching staff perspective, making sure the players on his roster appreciate what this game means.
Martez Carter for the 2nd time. This time picks up the yard to bring up 3rd down and 3. And back to the offense. It is amazing, Anthony, what the Tiger offense has done since Broderick Fobbs has taken over and brought that staff. And when he got here, they were averaging 19 points per game, up to 32 last year, and all the way up to 44 points per game this season. See what they can do here on 3rd down and 3. Rolling out toward 3 receivers is Williams, and hit just as he released it. And the defenses have come to play here in the 3rd quarter. Another 3 and out.
That time it was Daniel Brown. They moved the pocket, had a running back out in front of Jonathan Williams as he went on the boot action. Martez Carter not able to do enough. Justin Kelly was able to cut down Daniel Brown on the previous drive. Brown was ready.
And that's back-to-back 3 and outs from both teams. See if Willie Quinn gets a chance to bring this one back.
Peter!
Misplayed it a little bit. Like a ground ball coming through the infield. Goes down to the 25-yard line. That's a 57-yard punt.
Timeout.
With no return.
We're waiting, Willie. I want to see it.
5:02 left in the third quarter. Grambling continues to be on top of Southern. 24-20, back-to-back three and outs from both offenses that were hot as they came out of the halftime locker room. Defenses standing front and center here for both teams. Backup quarterback Deontay Shorts in for the second possession. Actually, that's Austin Howard. Back in after he sat out the last possession.
Well, I'm surprised that we didn't see Deontay Shorts run the football at all on the possession he was in. That's certainly his strength as an athlete slash quarterback.
Howard back to the air. Fires complete. Gain of 7. And that's Randall Menard. Brought down by Amphy.
On that particular snap, there wasn't as much stem before the snap of the football. So it does declare where the coverage will be more easily for Austin Howard as a quarterback.
Third down and 1. Look at the job Tillery did there. He was met before he got to the line of scrimmage. Kept his feet, picked up 8, and moves the chains.
Big back Malcolm Crockett, 210-pounder. The downhill guy, able to evade a defender in the backfield. It would have had him short of the first down. Able to move the sticks.
Tillery back in now at tailback. Excellent run by Crockett. Now a double bumps, reloads. Randall Menard thought he had it, ruled incomplete.
Menard has the frame to be able to make this play. There was a pump fake on the outside that Amphy just didn't bite on, and then he's there just waiting on Menard. Just couldn't keep his feet quite in bounds. Very close.
You mentioned that both offenses have kind of stalled here in the third quarter, but really the Southern offense began that stall back in the second quarter. First three possessions ended with touchdowns, and they've been searching for some kind of offense since. Second down 10, stepping up into the pocket. There's Willie Quinn, and Dawson Odoms talks about his unbelievable change of direction. You just saw it there as he gained 10.
Well, what we've seen is Grambling has been doing a more effective job with their linebackers in coverage, not allowing the easy reads, the throwing lanes there for Austin Howard with the shorter passes he completed earlier in the game.
Willie Quinn, 8 catches, 100 yards now. Look at the time. We do have a penalty marker down. As Howard skips it to Nico Talbert.
Well, to jump off sides is just one part of the no-no, but when I coach defensive line, the big bugaboo.
Offside, number 90 on the defense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Is once you do jump off sides, go ahead and finish the play. When you know the flag is coming, just go ahead and penetrate into the backfield. Larry Stalling there over the nose. So flag's gone, but then everyone up front just stops. The offense has a free play in that scenario. You have to finish that snap.
Yeah, Howard didn't exactly take advantage of that free play, just skipping a short pass.
Yeah, luckily for the Tigers, the secondary continued to play, so no one was open.
We'll take that first down at 5. And Willie Quinn would have liked that one a little bit further out in front of him, incomplete, to bring up second down 5.
They've used Willie Quinn out of the slot throughout the game today. A lot of slant routes, a lot of twos and fours, slants and curls, and allowed him to operate after the catch. 100 receiving yards in the game today. The second team all-SWAC performer as a kick returner, expected first team as a wide receiver. There, as you mentioned, Paul, just back on the back shoulder, threw behind Willie Quinn.
Likes this Bayou Classic. Last year, 5 catches, 78 yards and a touchdown. Today, 8 catches, 100 yards and a touch. This is Lennard Tillery skipping his way out to the 35-yard line in the Southern first down. Gain of 8. Brought down by Nicholas Peoples.
Tillery has very lively legs as a ball carrier. And the decisiveness that he has now as a third-year player, a junior, already their all-time leading rusher, back-to-back 1,000-plus-yard seasons.
There's Tillery once again. Active feet. Penalty marker comes in late. In the backfield, normally where it's holding, but Tillery would have enough for a first down if that play stands.
Holding. 6-2 offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
I was getting set to credit the offensive line for another outstanding block. That time, Allen Spry ends up getting called for holding, though. And their offense dictated a lot by angles, usually. But there, just a straight reach block from Spry. That's a very touchy call there for me.
Tillery right now with 72 rushing yards, long way to hit his average, which is a SWAC best 112 yards per game. Howard eyes downfield and fires that one out of bounds. Tiger defensive line continuing to affect Austin Howard here in the third quarter.
The crowd here at the Superdome certainly waking up with the wave. The momentum that Southern had started to build, just the same momentum of the wave here in the Mercedes-Benz Superdome. But the run game, Tillery, the offensive line, they really started to get it going. That holding flag that I disagreed with on Allen Spry now puts them far behind the chains, where it's so much more difficult for them to continue to use a ground and pound sort of mentality.
Second down, 20 to the air. Howard stands in. And he wanted Randall Menard, not even close to open. That's Deion Bonner with the coverage for Grambling, and it'll be third down 20.
We've gotten deeper into the drive now, where the pass rush for Grambling hasn't been as effective on the last couple of snaps. But there, again, just so different, so much more effective for the coverage, not allowing the receivers from Southern to get behind them. This, to me, is as big an improvement as we've seen for Grambling's defense as compared to where they were in the first season that they were in this scheme led by Everett Todd.
Think about where they were in the first quarter of this game. Austin Howard kind of made it look easy. Open receivers, kept it himself a bunch. Now he's been shut down. Facing third down and 20, play stops.
Delay of game, offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Dawson Odom's always very stoic. At least when the cameras are on. He certainly has fire that he delivers to his players. It's a big part of what he brought to this program. He put his imprint on it immediately.
Grambling State.
Actually coached under Lee Fobbs at North Carolina A&T, the father of Broderick Fobbs, who's on this staff for Grambling.
Well, any coach wouldn't like to see three penalties on one drive and his offense facing third down and 25. But as we see, the Tiger defensive staff also not happy. Third and 25 is good, but you know how it is. I mean, coaches are normally a little grumpy, especially defensive coaches. You can always find something to be unhappy about.
The intangible elements of this game are so interesting to me, Paul, because Grambling, we see all the fire from the coaches and the players going at it here during the timeout, but Grambling does have the Western Division already locked up. They're undefeated in SWAC play. They know that they're going to face Alcorn State next week in Houston for the SWAC championship, but this game still means so much. These two teams, Southern and Grambling, battling for recruits within this region of Louisiana and the southeastern part of the United States. This game, this pedestal that they have being on NBC Sports Network, it goes so many decades back. We got Broderick Fobbs now leading Grambling, who's brought them back to a level of prominence where this game is now again competitive.
But they've still lost three in a row, haven't knocked off the Jaguars since 2011. Jaguars facing third and 25. Willie Quinn going backwards. Continues to go the wrong way. Okay, it's Cooper. Nice piece of defense. And after all that, we have no gain.
It's always interesting when Willie Quinn gets the football. It's going to be fun to watch. It wasn't a lot for him to lose in this scenario on, you know, third and Baton Rouge. So he's trying to make a play, trying to evade some folks and see if he can go all the way back against the grain. But Arkaz Cooper just was having none of it.
Grambling defense holds once again. Sean McClain back to receive. 120 and counting in the third quarter. Penalty marker comes out right at the snap. The punt of 30 yards, and we'll check in to see about the penalty.
Illegal formation, offense, 5 men in the backfield. The 5 yards will be added to where Grambling will next put the ball in play. First down.
Illegal formation called there on the punt team.
A number of Hall of Famers from Southern and also from Grambling. Southern producing Mel Blount. Aeneas Williams, you see 4 there from Grambling. And Aeneas Williams, the most recent from this game to go into the Hall of Fame. There he is as a Southern Jaguar before he went on to an outstanding career as a corner, as a Cardinal. There he is with his busts. Right now he's in the sideline with Lewis Johnson.
And Paul, in February of 2016, Aeneas Williams and 5 others will be inducted into the Black Football Hall of Fame. And so in 2014, you went into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. What does this next honor mean to you?
Well, it's huge because everything started here at Southern University and historical black colleges. You know, my dad graduated from Southern, my brother graduated, so that was the fabric of our family. And getting the opportunity to walk on at Southern, you know, Southern University, I like to tell all the young people, when you're thinking about schools, don't just go to some of these bigger schools. Take trips to some of the historical black colleges, because Southern and the environment helped prepare me for on and off the field.
When you think back to yourself as a student-athlete, like we watch these young people today, in 91 you came out, what were your dreams for the game of football before all of this happened?
It was just really to work hard. And, you know, getting back to the original question as far as black college, when being selected to the Black College Hall of Fame, knowing how many of my predecessors, how many of these guys that I never thought I measured up to,
right,
and to now be a part of their company, and then being at Southern and playing in this Bayou Classic, getting the MVP, and we lost the game, still remembering that it wasn't about going to the pros. My parents challenged the students to be great academically, and then everything else turned out to be gravy.
Absolutely excellent. As you see Aeneas's family behind him, his children and a niece, and so they're the next generation. Congrats on all the honors, and we look forward to seeing you back here again next year, Aeneas.
Always good. Have a great game. Thank you, man.
Paul?
Lewis, Aeneas, thank you. From Southern Jaguar walk-on to Pro Football Hall of Famer, not a bad journey for Aeneas Williams. Got a pretty good fourth quarter coming up. 3 quarters in the books. Grambling has come from behind. They once trailed 20-3. They enter the final quarter leading 24-20. Fourth quarter of the 42nd annual Bayou Classic set to begin. It does so with the Tigers on top 24-20. They've won 8 consecutive games this season, but they've lost 3 in a row to the Southern Jaguars. Jonathan Williams sees something he likes down the middle, and that something is Chad Williams. Touchdown.
It was the skinny post that got it done. Jonathan Williams just slightly moves the pocket. Aaron Taylor can't get there in time. And then right inside of Danny Johnson in the secondary for the Jaguars, Chad Williams takes it the distance.
Chad Williams, number one receiver in the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Also averaging 16 yards per catch. First play of the fourth quarter. His biggest play of the game. And that's now 28 consecutive points for the Tigers.
The second season in a row that Chad Williams has been the leading receiver for Grambling State. Right over the top. Great delivery from Jonathan Williams. Right over the top of the oncoming defender. Chad Williams knows what to do with the football when he gets it in space.
4 catches, 75 yards. Also, just a great job of recognition and a quick move by Jonathan Williams. You mentioned the right over the top, but He recognized right away that Chad Williams was wide open, just set up as quick as he could and fired that one. And got it to him in stride, allowed him to just sprint into the end zone.
His second year in this offense, led by Eric Dooley. This is a position that Dawson Odoms hasn't found himself in at any point. Robert Cropps trying to win his first Bayou Classic as a head coach. Won a number of them as a player.
But we talked about right when the Tigers fell down 20-3 that their signature win of the season against Alcorn State, they had to come back from a 28-14 deficit. So they ought to be comfortable in a big game trailing. As it turns out, they certainly have been. However, Southern puts it on the ground and gave it right back to Grambling.
We saw a similar scenario play out last year where Mark Orozco, the kicker, placed the football precisely in a spot where the up-back had to field it and be indecisive about how to field it. Signals the fair catch very quickly, very briefly. And Danny Johnson, while he's coming up trying to field the football, it's just not a position he's used to being in.
Abubakar Kanse with the recovery, and that's three turnovers created by Grambling. Came into this game number one in the conference in that category. And that's Martez Carter, averaging 8.6 yards per carry this season. A little bit over that time as he gets nine. Jonathan Williams, the quarterback for Grambling last year, was huge in this game. Threw for 450 yards and four touchdowns. This year has three touchdowns, a little over 200 yards, and has his team on top by 11. Carter, nifty move. Gonna try it around the right side. How about the left? And the right. Jamal Jenkins finally there to bring him down. Numerous changes of direction leads to a loss of 21.
That's just silly. And I'm really surprised that Broderick Fobbs is even leaving Carter on the field at this point. I mean, he was one of his best playmakers. And showing confidence in the young man, but that's the type of decision that does not keep momentum in a ball game going.
And that's how you get third down and 22. Chester Rogers had a little bit of room, not nearly enough to pick up the first down. Jamal Jenkins there with a tackle, needed 21, got 11.
Well, Martez Carter is extremely explosive as an athlete. You see him there just to start and stop. He's got some speed, he's got the giddy up, but at some point you have to realize that you're making a bad play worse. And as a true sophomore, he apparently just doesn't have that level of awareness yet at this point in his career. Now you bring it up fourth and long. So punt team is on the field for Grambling.
Getting a number of versions. And they fake the punt. And the Tigers pick it up. The Grambling special team steps it up. That's Dre Fuseler. Penalty marker is down on the 25-yard line.
Dawson Odoms not sending his defense on the field yet.
41 on the offense. 10 yards penalty from the spot of the foul. Fourth down.
They're holding on the punt team for Grambling.
Called on Malcolm Williams, freshman linebacker.
Love the call, especially from that field position. I really anticipated they may go for fourth down anyway. But then Fuselier, as he gets the ball from the up-back position, showing his athleticism.
See if they actually punt it away this time. Yes, they do. Good catch, I guess.
Perhaps should have signaled the fair catch.
Southern with a chance to cut into that 11-point lead, 12:32 left in the game.
The world is constantly being refreshed.
The Bayou Classic on NBCSN is brought to you by Coors Light, official sponsor of HBCU Classics for over 25 years. Good shot of Louisiana Superdome, side of so many Super Bowls in the last 41 Bayou Classics. The first was played outside at Tulane Stadium before they moved it inside to accommodate the bigger crowds. Very good crowd inside the Superdome today. 12:32 left. Here come the Jaguars trailing by 11. Howard to Willie Quinn. Now with 9 catches for 108 yards. That one good for 8.
Able to tap the toes and stay in bounds there. It's not an offense for Southern that likes to operate in this manner of going spread and, you know, the tempo that you'll need to run being down 2 scores here, but they can do it.
Nice job by Leonard Tillery. See the 21 and a guy keeping his feet, thinking of LaDainian Tomlinson, another LT. That's a gain of 17.
Couldn't agree more. And the running style is actually very similar to LT by my estimation as well. A guy who runs through contact, but not really just based off sheer power. He uses his elusiveness as part of his ability to run through contact because you never really get a clean hit on him.
Eric Genoa, the injured Jaguar, on the field.
Timeout.
Back to the Superdome right after this.
Second down and 9.
Prime time?
Game time, go to McDonald's, baby.
I'm here to get the fans, the super fans, in on all the action.
First, get the food and pill, baby. You could win instantly.
I won $50.
Or text the code and watch the game to see if your team is picked.
You may win one of the guaranteed $500,000 weekly prizes.
Grambling fans, plenty of reason to cheer after they trailed 20-3. It's 28 consecutive points now. They lead 31-20. Southern offense with the football, moving first down and 10. Howard fires to his right. That's Randall Menard. Picks up 6. Jatarius Pouncey with the coverage. Speaking of sixes, Anthony, right now the Jaguars averaging 6 yards per rush. That much time left, only trailing 11. They don't have to abandon that run game that's been working so well. Tillery just enough for a first down. He picks up 5.
And that's what we see, where there is still some additional tempo to how Southern is operating offensively, but still using that run game. It moves the chains. It keeps the defense with a bit of balance for how they attack the pocket.
Southern running the ball well, however, been hurting themselves. 7 penalties have been costly, but not as costly as 3 turnovers. An interception and a fumble in the first half, and then special teams fumble here in the second half. Howard looks left to his right, steps up, and there's Tillery across the 45-yard line. And he picks up 7, brought down by Arquez Cooper.
I like that decision. It's a good read because he looked off the coverage. Safety's deep. Throw it underneath. While it doesn't pick up a first down, it just keeps you on schedule.
Guy Stallworth been awfully busy for the Tiger defense. He leads him with 12 tackles. And that's a completion to Nico Talbert, brought down by our guy there, Guy Stallworth, for another tackle, but that is also another Southern first down.
Got a couple of very diminutive targets in the slot between Nico Talbert and Willie Quinn.
Looks like he has a free play. Fires it near the end zone. Wanted Randall Menard. A lot of contact there. No flag. A little post-play discussion. One more ask for a flag.
Bernard's kind of giving him the talk to the hand there, but in live action, off the free play. I really felt like Menard was the one pushing off. It's fairly lucky he wasn't called for offensive pass interference.
To his right, Willie Quinn. Look at that quickness. Still on his feet. Wow. Reverse direction there. Picks up 18.
Willie Quinn's only a junior, so he's got a lot of gameplay left to break some of these all-time return records. So we'll have plenty of opportunities to continue to watch the human joystick that is fast Willie Quinn.
Came in with 37 receptions, has 11 today, over 100 yards, also has a touchdown, scored the first touchdown early in the first quarter. Jaguars on the move, spin move, Tillery. Brought down to the 18-yard line after he picks up two, brought down by Arquez Cooper.
The tendency sometimes, once you get into the red zone, inside the 20, where plays can take a little bit longer to signal in and out, you're a bit deeper into the drive. For a team that's down two scores, Dawson Odoms and Southern need to be conscious. It looks like Willie Quinn went down on the sideline there. You hope it's nothing major, hopefully just a cramp or something like that. But Southern needs to be conscious of not allowing too much time to run off between plays where you know you need multiple possessions to get back into the game.
Tillery, the only back in the SWAC, averaging over 100 yards per game. He's at 90. Penalty marker comes in. Looks like he gave a yard back there. Willie Quinn, top receiver in this game, continues to stay down on the sideline.
They're stretching him, giving him fluids.
75 offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Second down.
For more on Willie Quinn, let's check in with Lewis Johnson.
Yeah, Paul, in the first half, he was having some issues with some cramping. They were working out that left calf. Now they're looking at the right hamstring. And so that was an issue, but he said he could continue to play. And yesterday I asked him about, you know, this being 5'5 and how he takes advantage of that. He says, you know, I use my quickness and my speed, and defenders have got to come way down low to get me. And he loves to use that low leverage to his advantage. Kid in Pop Warner was a running back, moved to wide receiver, and his former coach told him that he could be a great one because of his quickness, the low leverage, and his speed.
Been the best receiver in this game so far, Lewis. Austin Howard wanted Talbert. A little bit high. There's Randall Menard. And it brings up third down 18.
The physiology of different athletes, just, you know, you can never predict who will battle what. But Willie Quinn has been a player that has battled cramping throughout his career. It's come up fairly frequently for him, but he always gets some water, gets hydrated, gets some fluids, and then re-enters the lineup.
So third down and 18, maybe even thinking about getting half of that back to make a field goal attempt a little more manageable.
Chris Pittman, the kicker, hasn't made anything outside of 35 yards this season.
Austin Howard. And there's Willie Quinn. Can he get the first? No. Ball came out late. But Howard to Quinn for 12. We saw Quinn on the sidelines a moment ago. Now he stays down to the field.
It's very difficult, as Lewis Johnson reporting, Willie Quinn dealing with cramping throughout the game today. You see them immediately start in a massaging of both calves, but here he is, you know, planning, starting, stopping out in the open field, trying to gain additional yardage, but obviously that force you're putting into the ground, using those muscles in the lower body, all those sinews as they tighten up while you're trying to make those explosive movements.
So fourth down and 6. And a field goal would make it a one possession game. Would cut the Tiger lead to 8. This is a field goal attempt of 33 yards. See if Greg Pittman can knock it through. Right down the middle. First points of the second half for the Jaguars. Cut that Grambling lead to 8.
Swag Nation, the countdown to Judgment Day has begun. The turnip continues. The 2015 Toyota Swag Football Championship, December 5th in NRG Stadium. When the best of the East clash with the best of the West, get ready for some hard-hitting, non-stop action football. Check out the pregame tailgate party featuring Juicy J. The halftime battle of the bands. Then, immediately following the game, it's the king of R&B, R. Kelly.
Make some noise.
Tickets are as low as $17. For tickets and more information, go online to swagfootball.org.
Just me and you talking here, Paul.
Yes.
You moved from West Coast to East Coast. Have you become more green or less green?
We became awfully green on the West Coast and then maintained that level of green.
I like it.
It's a fine question, though. Yeah. It's a good thing to do, right, Ed?
Agreed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm working on my green.
Good Midwestern guy. Yeah. Ought to come naturally. As for the game here, 42nd Bayou Classic. Way back when, the Jaguars led 20-3, scoring on their first three possessions. But Grambling has been hot, rolled up 28 consecutive points. Look at Southern's three turnovers. They've also had eight penalties in addition to that. They also, early in the second half, roughed the punter to get the ball back to Grambling, and they scored a touchdown on that drive. So self-inflicted wounds for Southern, and an offense that's gotten hot here for Grambling. Pick up two right there.
Sorry, partner. That was a really big kick that Greg Pittman made there, nearly equaling his long for the season. He'd made a 35-yarder earlier in the year, that 33-yarder. That makes him 5 out of 8 for the season, but now a one-score game again. Big decision worked out for Dawson Odoms.
Williams quickly out wide. Chester Rogers turns the corner, picks up a Tiger first down, gets inside of Jaguar territory. Run out of bounds by Henry. But he gained 16.
Throughout the half, there's been a bit more of a methodical pace, you know, by Grambling standards for what they normally do offensively. They still operate fast compared to most people here.
Kelly right up the middle, keeps his feet. Another Grambling first down. Impressive run, gets 11 before he's tackled by Preston.
And now the starters rotating back in for that Southern defensive front. Dawson Odoms, the head coach, works directly with the defensive line. He tries to rotate as many bodies in as he can, but it can be difficult against this Grambling offense because of the tempo they operate and the way they go no huddle. A lot of teams now facing so much no huddle have a better feel for how to rotate.
First down and 10 now for the Southern 33. Right back to Kelly up the middle, brought down to the 30-yard line. And a moment ago, Anthony, you mentioned what Grambling normally does on offense. Let's back up. Earlier this season, the first of their eight consecutive victories, they scored 34 points. They haven't scored less than 35 cents. And right now they sit at 31. A little over 6 minutes left to see if they can get that up over the mark they're used to. And for the season, they're at 44 points per game.
Credit to not only head coach Broderick Fox, but we referenced his offensive coordinator, Eric Dooley.
Why not keep it on the ground? Kelly back up the middle to the 27-yard line, gains 3, brought down by Daniel Brown. So there we go, the results, all kinds of big numbers. 5 times they've been over 40, over 50 once, they hit 70 one time. 3 games in a row over 40. 31 points this afternoon at this point with 5:31 left in the game. Good enough for an 8-point lead. And right now facing 3rd down and 5. Williams with time. And right on the money. Tiger gain of 13 yards. That's complete to Verlin Hunter.
Just such a pure pass. Hits him right on the deuce. It's almost like the ball caught Verlin Hunter, as sure-handed as he is. Always like the release of Jonathan Williams. We see him season by season, more decisive, more in tune, more sound with how he operates both inside and outside of the pocket.
One problem coming into this game, they've thrown 15 interceptions. Has avoided that problem today. 0 picks. Also thrown 3 touchdowns. That's Chester Rogers along the right side. Nice catch. Picks up six.
Keeping the football out of harm's way. It puts that level of pressure on the defense. When you've got an athletic quarterback threatening the numbers as a ball carrier, then delivering it outside. You do that working towards the wide side of the field, then the defense, as they're operating with you, it's that much more imperative for them to stay within their coverage space.
You wonder if and when Southern will start to use those timeouts. They have three remaining. If they don't use them, Tigers can just keep it on the ground. Of course, penalty will stop the clock.
False start. 6-7 offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Left guard in that situation, Paul Nosworthy. It's a little flinch, a wiggle of the hips. Aaron Tiller willing to point him out.
Justin Kelly to the 11-yard line, picks up two.
We reference, Paul, the time continuing to tick away. It appears right now Broderick or Dawson Odom still in the mindset of wanting to maintain the timeouts, hoping his defense can come up with some sort of a stop here and then have those timeouts remaining to operate offensively. Big third down.
Grambling just going to let those seconds tick off as the play clock now finally at 10 seconds. And they can bring this well under 2 minutes. Keep it on the ground and get it closer to two if they want to just try a field goal, which would make it a two-possession game, but let a little too much time run off.
Grambling State has called his third and final timeout of regulation play.
2:53 left on third down. Tigers on top by 8.
The C-Spy program is...
That there is the brand new trophy, all ready to go to the winner of the 42nd Bayou Classic. Might look good in somebody's trophy case there on campus. Right now, that somebody looks like it could be the Grambling Tigers. They lead 31-23, third down and 7. They keep it on the ground and leaping Chester Rogers. Got near the goal line, picked up 8. Athletic moves down the right side, going to keep this drive alive.
It's great work by his offensive teammates maintaining blocks, and then just as Rogers looked like he was going to go out of bounds, put that last effort in there, stuck that right foot in the ground, and then leaps from just inside the 5-yard line going airborne.
And stepped out just before he got the first down.
The ruling on the field is that the ball carrier stepped out of bounds.
So 22-yard field goal attempt coming.
The previous play is under review.
Mark Orozco, and that would make it the all-important two-possession lead for the Tigers.
We will review the spot of the football here. Official Roderick Holloway will go get on the headset. For the left foot, it's like maybe it's just tapping the white there, which would mean that the ruling on the field was correct. How about that effort and athleticism from Rogers?
Well, if that right foot is ruled in, he got awfully close to getting that ball across the stripe. I'm sorry, the left foot there, because the right foot stays in right there. Wow. There's the step in question.
And on the field of play during live action, it was ruled that that left foot was out of bounds. And if it was, I mean, the spot was just about accurate. I mean, it's an impressive spot from the line judge.
When that ball came out, it's awfully close.
The ruling on the field that the runner stepped out at the 5 stands. Fourth down.
The ruling on the field stands that he did step out of bounds to bring up fourth down. Mark Orozco. ...22-yard attempt. Right down the middle. Southern has three timeouts left. They also have an 11-point deficit. Time now to take a look at the McDonald's plays of the game.
Starts with Nicholas Peoples in the secondary. Big INT in the first half. And then a takeaway. You see White Ampey and his crew hustling to the football. Stuffing the run game for the second and third quarter, really. And here, Arkes Cooper, the pursuit. The hallmark of any great defense. These Grambling State Tigers haven't completely shut down their opponent, Southern. But they've been able to find a way behind defensive coordinator Everett Todd, who also works with their D-line, to control the Southern offense enough to have a two-score lead here with just over 2 minutes remaining in the Bayou Classic.
And Anthony, how many times have you heard a coach at any level say it's not how you start, it's how you finish? Well, the Southern offense scored touchdowns on its first three possessions. They've now gone six in a row without scoring a touchdown. Mike Jones been busy on kickoff return today as the Tigers have avoided kicking off to Willie Quinn because he has five return touchdowns already this season. They didn't want to see a sixth. And now Austin Howard and that Jaguar offense going to have to get to work. They preserved those three timeouts. Certainly could have made an argument why they should have used them on defense in the last possession. They did not. They have all three, 1:59 left, trailing 34-23.
There's most certainly weaponry available to Austin Howard in the passing game. And I would say between the two quarterbacks on the field of play today, Austin Howard has the more arm talent between the two of them.
Also is the only one who's thrown an interception this afternoon. His first in his last eight games. Howard steps up. Goes down to the 38-yard line.
And Mike Jones had a big imprint on last season's game, the first two touchdown receptions in the 2014 Bayou Classic. He's mainly just been used as the up-back, fielding these kickoffs, these pooch kicks they've gotten from Grambling. Haven't heard from him much today.
Both teams with 72 offensive plays at this point. Jaguars 420 total yards. The Tigers 454. The difference is the three turnovers for Southern. Zero for Grambling. Almost a pick right there. Incomplete to bring up third down.
Well, curl routes.
Jatarius Pouncey.
Sorry, partner. Curl routes aren't going to be what gets Southern back into this game offensively. If you're going to attack the defense, you see the eyes of Austin Howard. We're looking down, staring down the receiver, Randall Menard. That allows the secondary that opportunity to converge on the spot he's throwing the football to.
The clock continues to tick here now at 57 seconds. That was an incomplete pass.
It was an incomplete pass. You are correct, sir.
About 20 seconds ran off the clock after the ball was incomplete.
All right. Game clock now reset.
There we go. 20 back on. Buck 17 left. Third down and five. Howard to the left, now to his right, flushed out of the pocket. And run out of bounds before he got back to the line of scrimmage. That's Guy Stallworth, leading tackler for the Tiger defense. That'll bring up fourth down.
It's difficult to recognize in that scenario, but even just hitting the dump off where Lennard Tillery was open out of the backfield, he was short of the sticks, but it's in rhythm. You hit him in stride, and he has an opportunity to pick up a first down, which would, in that case, stop the clock. Then you can clock it. It's just these two-minute drill speed sort of scenarios that Austin Howard hasn't had to work from behind very often.
First sack of the game. That brings up fourth down and seven. The Jaguars right now two out of three converting fourth down. And there's the second sack of the game. And that one will be the dagger. Oh.
Michael Jolly vet. We've been waiting for several years for a moment like this.
Make that seven possessions in a row. The Grambling defense kept the Jaguars out of the end zone after they scored touchdowns on their first three. How sweet it must be for this whole senior class. Tigers haven't won the Bayou Classic since 2011.
As much credit as the Tigers offense gets, deservedly so, that Gatorade bath over defensive coordinator Everett Todd is much deserved. Grambling State looking at being the first team since 2008 to finish their SWAC schedule with an undefeated 8-0 conference record. Last team to do that, the Grambling State Tigers.
Broderick Fobbs' defense came into this game when the conference ranked number one rushing defense, but it's the number one in takeaways that really stood out today. They win the turnover battle 3-0. They get 32 takeaways on the season as they head into that conference title game next weekend in Houston. Quarterback Jonathan Williams going to be your MVP today. Goes 20 out of 34 for 272. Three touchdowns to give him 36 on the season. Also ran it nine times for 78 yards and a touchdown. Starting quarterback accounts for well over 300 yards, a total offense of four touchdowns and zero turnovers. And that's how you win the Bayou Classic.
There's quite a ball club that awaits Grambling State next week in Alcorn State. They will enjoy this one for a short time and get ready for the SWAC championship game.
Broderick Fobbs, two seasons as the head coach, his Tigers 16-2 in conference play. And now they win the Bayou Classic for the first time since 2011. Unbeaten in conference play, the Grambling Tigers for the first time since 2008. Nine consecutive wins for the Tigers, 34-23 over their arch rivals, Southern Jaguars. Let's go down to the field, joined by Lewis Johnson.
Coach, you're down 20-3, but talk about the way your team rallied to get this Bayou Classic win. Your first is...
I tell you, my kids are so resilient. They've been through a lot, and I'm just fortunate to have them. Just a great football team. We played against a really good football team in Southern University, Class Act. They do a great job, and this is a battle of two really good programs. You know, they say that, you know, the Bayou Classic has lost its luster. I don't think so.
What do you have to say quickly about your defense and then the way your quarterback also led the team today?
Well, I tell you, I was pleased with the way we played from the second quarter on.
Right.
I thought the first quarter we got kind of wild by the lights a little bit, and they kind of hit us in the mouth, and we had to regroup. I thought our kids did a good job of regrouping.
Congratulations, and good luck in the SWAC championship game next week.
Thank you so much.
All right. Coach Lewis, thank you very much. Anthony Heron, final thoughts on what you saw from Grambling today.
This is what the Bayou Classic should be and what it's been the last couple of seasons now. Grambling State, for the first time in 3 years, coming up with a victory. This is where these two programs are supposed to be at. Roderick Fobbs and Dawson Odoms will be going at it for years to come.
Saw Jonathan Williams there. He accounted for 450 yards passing last year in a loss, 350 yards total offense, and the win today. That's going to do it for us here at the Mercedes-Benz Louisiana Superdome. The final score in the 42nd Bayou Classic, Grambling 34 and Southern at 23. Coming up next, NFL Turning Point. For our entire NBC Sports crew, I'm Paul Burmeister, thanking you for watching the Bayou Classic on NBCSN. Thanks for being with us, and so long from New Orleans.